Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2024 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent. We've had apologies for today from Gordon MacDonald, and Colin Beattie is attending today as an SNP substitute member. I welcome Colin to the meeting. Mark Griffin is unable to join us for the start of the meeting but will join us as soon as he can. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Accounts Commission report, Local Government in Scotland Financial Bulletin 2022-23. And we're joined by Joe Armstrong, who's the Chair of the Accounts Commission, Andrew Burns, who's the Deputy Chair of the Accounts Commission, Carol Calder, who is the Audit Director at Audit Scotland, Blythe Deans, who is the Senior Manager at Audit Scotland, and Lucy Jones, who is Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And in particular, I would like to welcome Jo to her first committee meeting as Chair of the Accounts Commission.
Thank you.
Yes, I have a very short opening statement, but I'm pleased to be here as the new Chair, and pleased that my new Deputy Chair, Andrew, is with me, and the colleagues from Audit Scotland, who are effectively the powerhouse between the Accounts Commission and developing the analysis and the evidence that we use in our reports. I wanted to kind of start off by saying our role principally in the Accounts Commission is to provide independent reporting on the performance and finances of Scotland's public bodies. As the new chair, I am seeking to reinforce and develop the Commission's approach by focusing in on using the sector's own data to monitor and report on performance and best value. So not looking to add to the burden of local authorities' data collection, but make different use of what's already out there. A key priority is to ensure the Commission delivers effective and scrutiny of Scotland's local bodies, and in doing so identify and share best practice where we find it, because I think it's important we flag up where things are going well, as well as flag up issues or where it might not be working quite so well. Clearly, our financial bulletin that we're going to discuss this morning clearly signals the increased strain on Council's finances that reinforces the need for more, and we would argue, faster transformational change to ensure services are maintained. We like to think the commitments that were made public in both the Verity House Agreement and in relation to fiscal framework gives us in the Commission an opportunity to build on our reputation for independent and objective scrutiny, something that we think is needed even more so now than ever. And so we wait to see what happens with what's coming out of the Verity House Agreement and the fiscal framework. I'm no doubt we'll go into questions on that at the session this morning, so I really want to close by saying I'm looking forward to answering your questions across not just the fiscal report, but probably our wider work programme as well. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thanks very much. And so it's helpful to hear just that brief overview of priorities there. And I think really a great approach to be going for using the sector's own existing data and also sharing best practice across local authorities. I would be interested to understand how the Commission intends to measure and maximise the impacts on achieving its aims.
A good question. We look at a variety of different reports and approaches to try and make sure our view of what's happening in the sector are made available and accessible across the public sector and across communities in Scotland. So we use formal reporting, we use blogs, we use videos, we use internet approaches as a way of reaching as broad a spectrum as possible to be able to show what we're doing. And then we seek consultations on what we are doing to make sure that what we're doing, people feel that it's the right thing we're doing, and that we are constantly monitoring what we're doing to make sure we're not doing things that are inappropriate. So, for example, looking at the data side of things, there's a plethora of data out there. What we want to try and make sure is the data that we do use is the right data, and we don't ask for more data to be delivered or gathered by local authorities. So it's trying engaging with our stakeholders as best we can, and listening to what our stakeholders are asking us to do to make sure that we are delivering what it is they think is best to be able to report on the performance of the sector.
Great. So it sounds like quite a lot of interaction and consultation, dialogue.
Trying to do that, yes.
Yeah. Great. As you'll be aware, the Local Government Information Unit found that confidence in the sustainability of council finances in Scotland is critically low. And I'd be interested to understand what the Commission's views are on the sustainability of local government finance, government finances. And are these any different to the concerns expressed by the Commission over the last few years?
As the new chair and reading back, we are seeing similar themes coming through now as we did that before. And what is a testament to the sector is it managed to maintain sustainability through year-on-year efficiency savings, through year-on-year adaptations. What we are arguing for now is that given the financial challenges that face not just the country but also local government, is that those financial challenges make it harder and harder to deliver current levels of service, but we know that demand is growing. So the likelihood of being able to continue to deliver efficiency savings and maintain services is harder and harder to justify. So it's transformational change that we would now be arguing for. We've been saying in the past we need to increase the pace of change. We're actually now saying it needs to be transformational change.
Okay, thanks for that. Andrew.
Thanks very much, Convener. And just to amplify what the Chair was saying, I mean, I think the Financial Bulletin 22-23, which we're discussing this morning, does show there is a slight difference, because I know this is partly potentially behind your question, there is a slight difference between the picture here as compared to down south in England. I mean, the Financial Bulletin does find that no council in Scotland is at immediate financial risk in 22-23, but I think it's really important to underline that there's no certainty that that will continue. There really are extremely challenging financial decisions ahead of local authorities in Scotland. They're not in the same position as England, but there's a risk they could be in the medium to long term, and they are going to have to make very difficult decisions about changes to local services. But there is that distinct difference at the moment between the position down south and here in Scotland, but the risks are still very significant and still present.
Okay, thanks for highlighting that, Andrew. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol, who actually has questions around the Financial Bulletin.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you very much for your opening statement. I just want to probe a little bit more into the Financial Bulletin. Obviously, it outlines the significant financial challenges confronting local authorities, categorise them as unprecedented. It underscores the council budget deficit of £725 million for the fiscal year 2023-2024. Could the Commission provide a little bit more detail into the overall budget shortfall for the current fiscal year and elaborate on the strategies and local councils are devising to address these gaps?
Can I, first of all, pick up on the financial gaps? I mean, I think it's important to note, again, as Andrew said, the financial gaps are being funded principally by reducing reserves, using surpluses. So there are no imminent kind of challenges of facing local authorities and not being able to deliver what they've set out in their budgets to deliver. I think the challenge that the sector sees is around the kind of difference of opinion as to whether more or less money is needed for delivering of services based on an expected council tax revenue raising opportunity. I think it's important that we think through how do we understand what the services that we need to be delivered and then get this clarity around what funding is required to deliver that. We don't have clarity on either at the moment, really, but we do have budgets that are based on historic positions. So last year drives a lot of what happens next year, and service delivery drives a lot of what service delivery is next year. What we would be suggesting and what we are seeking in our best value reports is to ensure that local authorities are mindful of their long-term financial sustainability and are therefore indicating how, through transformational change, they're going to be able to change how they deliver their services to be able to make sure they don't have to rely on reserves, because once reserves are used up, clearly they're not there for future purposes. I'm going to open up to my colleagues on my left here, Blythe, who has got more of the detail around some of those numbers, if that's what you would like to understand a bit more on.
Thank you, Joanne Strong. But also, you've probably probed into some of my supplementary as well. Do you want me to say that as well, please? So, you know, you did mention in your opening statement about we need faster transformation of change due to the account of finances. I was lucky enough to speak to 31 councils out of 32 councils, the CEOs, and they did mention, obviously, looking at reserves, and they did mention their spending and everything. But I want to talk a little bit about what you've just touched on, outdated council tax and NDR models, pending a wholesome, basically, reassessment of the local government funding. And has there been any exploration of alternative revenue-making strategies that council could use? Are you aware of anything that they're moving to? Because you did also mention that services basically we need to look at services that need to be delivered today. So, transformation.
I certainly have no view on the appropriateness or otherwise of the NDR approach in the funding of local government. That's clearly for politicians to decide on. The challenge is around what are the level of service needed and what's the funding required to do that. And if we're talking about financial challenges in the economy as a whole, clearly there are financial challenges facing service delivery. It's not just the GDP deflator, it's not just general inflation that's the issue, it's the specific inflation that affects the delivery of services. So wage increases in the care sector, for example, have risen by faster than inflation, which means the budget available to fund care is going to have to go further because it's having to pay out more on wages. But I'll hand over to Blythe if you want to pick up on any of the specific numbers, Blythe.
Sure, thank you. Yeah, so I can provide a wee bit more colour around some of the bridging actions or the actions that councils have taken to set a balanced budget. So effectively, what have they done in response to those budget gaps? So I think savings is a key part of that, as you might expect. But what we've tried to analyse as part of our report is the relationship between recurring and non-recurring savings. Clearly, as more recurring savings are made, it's less easy for councils to find more. So that means that there's an increased reliance on those non-recurring actions. Clearly, there's sustainability issues in terms of doing that year after year. So as the Chair of the Commission says, that is why that there's been that probably increased focus within our reports, recommending that the transformational change is almost the only way that councils are going to maintain that financial sustainability. There are other methods that councils can use, obviously use of reserves being one of them. I can talk about reserves at length. I'm sure it will come up as a separate question. But no, certainly the savings part of this is critical. And as you can see in Exhibit 15 in the report, councils agreed £239 million of recurring savings, and their track record in delivering them is pretty good. So, yeah, we can take confidence from that. But as I say, that challenge is going to get more intense as years go on.
I just wanted to talk about the fiscal framework. So you mentioned council tax and NDR models. What we're hoping to see in the Verity House agreement, the fiscal framework, what that sets out. But what we've been calling for, and local government have been calling for, is more certainty about the money that councils will get. Not only that, but the Verity House agreement agrees to the Charter for Local Self-Government. And localism is kind of an underlying principle with national, local by default, national by agreement. In order for that to happen, there has to be more flexibility about how councils can use the money. So less in-year money that comes in, more certainty, multi-year budgets, less directed funding, and also pursuing those routes for revenue raising as well, which would include things like council tax or visitor levy, for instance. So we wait to see what the fiscal framework will look like, but we hope that it provides more flexibility so that councils can plan for the future on the longer term horizon, which is where transformation is important, looking at a prevention agenda and focusing on resources on those most in need.
Thank you. Could I just ask one more supplementary on this, just in what you've mentioned there, Blythe Staines, in relation to obviously councils have savings they can do, but obviously that may have effects year on year. But reserves, I'm going to come back to asking a question on that later. But one of the areas that the concerns the council raised was they might be okay this year, they might be okay next year, but the fact is in the coming years there are going to be serious problems that savings and reserves and certain money cannot be used. And it's understandable that you mentioned transformational change, but have you forecasted anything further than so many years on, looking at where do they end up if they don't do this transformational change?
We don't do forecasting. We do in our best value reports and our analysis of local government, we do get their budgets, their forecast budgets, and they do forecasting. The challenge they have is they can only put a plug a line in on what they think the revenue is going to be, best guess. So we're not seeing anything that suggests there's an imminent danger of a local authority not being able to maintain a balanced budget. The corollary to that also clearly is that the ability to actually get access to services gets harder and harder. Mm-hmm. The bar to which you have to pass to get services gets harder and harder. So it's not about not being able to fund what they're doing, it's whether what they're funding and what they're doing is adequate for what Scottish electorate believe is what's needed. And I think part of what we are trying to think through is how do we help create the debate and the environment for an honest conversation about what is it that local government can deliver and what is it that we need to find other means by which people can be supported in their communities.
Thank you.
Thank you. Great, thanks. Thank you. Willie, you want to come in with a supplementary?
Hi, thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, everybody. The report, the figures in the report are for 22-23, of course, but looking slightly ahead, the position might, we could argue, look a little bit better, with an extra £574 million being allocated to local councils next year. That's a cash terms uplift of 4.3% or a real terms uplift of 2.5%. Has the Commission had any chance to do a current analysis of the current figures and the potential impact that may have in resolving some of the issues that have been discussed around the table so far?
We don't, as I said before, we don't do forecasting. We do ask for... and we do get the information from local government about their budgets, and that helps us understand where they're sitting in terms of their forecast for budgets. And I know we've got a report coming out this week or next on our budget, so I don't want to preempt what that's going to say. But we are mindful of making sure that we understand what's happening year on year, not just on historic data, but also in the future. I think, as Carol said, that the challenge that local government has is the ability to actually plan effectively when they've got limited flexibility around some lines. Increasing the flexibility is, in our view, a good thing, and their unring fencing of some of the budget lines is a good thing. But it means then localism has to be to the fore, and the challenge then is, have we got enough clarity around what local communities are looking for and what they want from the local government services? And part of our request of local government is that we see them engaging locally and we understand their engagement strategies that helps them drive their priorities and their decision making. That's part and parcel of what we do as our best value.
Okay. Thanks for that, Jo. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move on to bring in questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Morning.
To the panel. Thanks for joining us today. In some of the recommendations the Commission put forward, one was regarding the prioritisation of recurring savings. And I just wondered if you could outline examples of good practice in that area as you see it, and to what extent recurring savings are actually now becoming more difficult to identify and achieve.
I'll come back to my colleagues about specific examples, if that's all right with you, Miles. But I think what Blythe indicated earlier and what is inevitably a truism: if you keep making savings year on year, then either you didn't need the money or you're not managing to deliver the services that are necessary, because the service costs in the main will be rising with at least the level of inflation, if not higher. So the likelihood of being able to continue to deliver efficiency savings that are just efficiency savings rather than transformational becomes harder and harder to achieve. We are challenging councils when they come to our meetings, is to say, how can we get comfort that you are in line? You can put a number in a line, you can show in a budget that it's going to balance because you've just put a number in there. What is it you're doing that gives us comfort that line number, that saving, is actually achievable and deliverable? And that gets harder and harder as the years go on, that they keep doing it. In terms of examples of good practice of savings, Blythe, have you got anything you can... I'm putting you on the spot. My apologies for that.
I can come in on that. You're right, it gets more difficult to make the recurring savings. I think for 22-23, 37% of the bridging actions for the budget gaps were recurring savings. The use of reserves was 34%, and the increases in council tax were 17%, and then 12% via various different other methods. So recurring savings is quite a chunk, but the difficulty is in terms of thinking about how debt has been reprofiled with the service concessions that have been allowed, is kicking that down the road a little bit. So it's what's the sustainability in the future by reprofiling debt over a longer period of time? That's one of the issues that's part of the financial sustainability, and which is why the Commission have been talking about the meat's cut off the bone in terms of efficiency. So now it is about transformation. And what we mean by that is really fundamental redesign, councils working together, delivering one council delivering for Scotland, or joint councils, regional partnerships, collaboration with communities and co-production, all of that. It's set out quite nicely in the Solus paper on delivering a future for Scottish local authorities. And that's the kind of things that we're talking about when we talk about transformation. So it's more about asking the question, what are councils for? And I think that document refers to them as being delivery agnostic and enablers of place. That's the kind of shift that we're not quite seeing yet. But Solus have produced this paper with very clear direction that they want to go in. But there are some significant barriers to making that transformational change happen. But I think financial sustainability is, in order to achieve financial sustainability in the longer term, we have to look at transformational change.
Thank you for that. I noted that overall debt, net debt, had increased by £1 billion. And I just wondered if there was any explanation the Commission had managed to find around that. And specifically, are there, and we touched on this earlier, specific councils who have more exposure to that debt than others? And are these the sort of at-risk councils, you think, for the future?
Again, borrowing has to be done on the basis of its prudential and that there's affordability and ability to pay back. So we don't get involved in looking at that in detail in the Commission, but we do look at the extent to which some of the metrics that they're monitoring, so kind of revenue to debt, interest payments, we're beginning to look more closely at those sorts of metrics to see whether or not that any sustainability or challenge might be coming through. In the event of not being given an uplift on capital or capital funding being lower than perhaps had been anticipated, debt's the obvious solution to being able to plug a gap if you've got a project you want to put forward. So I think it's going to be harder and harder to deliver the infrastructure projects required without using borrowing. But the corollary to that then is it an affordable borrowing programme that is being funded? Again, Lyth, is that something you can pick up on?
Yeah,
in more
sure.
Detail?
Thank you. Yeah, so in terms of the net debt movement itself, much like we found last year, the main movements were essentially just in relation to either reduction in cash and investment balances or just increases to short or long-term borrowing. So again, there was nothing particularly out of the ordinary when we looked at that in detail. One of the things that might be quite interesting for the committee, though, is that the cost of servicing that debt has actually went down. Now, that's linked to what's already been mentioned in terms of pushing the term slightly longer, meaning that the annual repayments are less. So just to illustrate that with some figures, in 2013-14, 8.4% of the general revenue budget was used to service that debt. It's come down to 5.4%. So there's some movements in between there. Some examples, for example, South Ayrshire Council being one. Cash and investments went down from 17 to 11 million. So again, quite a significant impact in terms of that net debt position. Eastern Bartonshire Council also an almost £20 million reduction in cash and investments, which has had that knock-on impact in terms of that net profile. The debt profile, sorry. In terms of the reason for some of that, again, there's potentially been some borrowing to take advantage of attractive interest rates to assist with cash flow purposes, but also, as Joe says, there's obviously a big capital impact in terms of that borrowing profile as well. So nothing majorly concerning coming out of that analysis. And on the point about correlation between certain councils and the debt profile. It's not something we've carried out as part of this analysis, so I wouldn't be able to offer a position on that one.
No, thank you for that. And I know last year we saw that one-off reprofiling of PPP debt as well, which I think probably is in those figures. Finally, I just wanted to ask, and this is something I've raised before with regards to the funding formula COSLA use, but just wondered if the Commission had done any work or intends to do any work around population growth and demands on councils, both in terms of Lothian here, where we expect about 80% of all growth in Scotland, but also depopulation in other councils, for example, Argyll and Bute. So just wondered if that was a piece of work the Commission was also going to be doing further work on.
We haven't yet discussed that, Carol. You want to pick up?
Yeah, just that the Commission, or Audit Scotland, on behalf of the Commission, have looked at the funding formula in the past, and it is a discussion to be had with Scottish Government and COSLA, because there are always winners and losers if you change the formula. Mm-hmm. What we did find was there's a very weak correlation between funding and deprivation, but actually a very strong correlation between funding and population levels. So there are many different elements to the equation, but the biggest driver is population.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Great, thanks. I just wanted to continue on that thread. So earlier this year in March, we looked at the issue of loan funds and capital finance accounting and heard that regulations introduced in 2016 allowed councils to extend loans fund to extend loan fund repayments into the future, then adds that pressure onto future budgets. As most local authorities have used that those flexibilities, I'd be interested to understand if the Commission has a concern that future taxpayers could end up paying for assets that will actually no longer exist.
I think it's important to understand that when you do have an asset, clearly it has to be maintained. So the issue for us would be, are you taking on an asset that you then not got the capacity to fund the capital maintenance programme for that? It's not something we look at closely at the moment, I don't believe so. Blythe, is that correct? Being able to extend the term of a loan to free up resources now could be argued as a good thing if you're then using that resource to allow you to do either an innovation or an investment in something that will allow you to do a cheaper service or a more cost-effective service in the future. We're asking questions around, are the benefits from, for example, the triennial pension benefit that's come through, is that being used for refiguring and recasting service delivery as a way of then reducing costs in the future, or is it just to plug gaps? Again, we're seeing mixed picture on that. Extending the life of a loan, if it's properly maintained, is not necessarily a bad thing, but it does add to the cost, that it does actually, ironically, add to the ring fencing of funding in the future, expenditures in the future, which one could argue is a good thing or a bad thing, depending on which side of the coin you're sitting.
Maybe it's something for us to keep an eye on. Right? We don't have a crystal ball, really, on those things. But no. OK, I'm going to bring Pam Goshall back in with questions around reserves.
Thank you, Convener. So I've just got a couple of questions around the reserves. The presentation of local authority reserves is sometimes interpreted as council sitting on large amounts of surplus money. Could the Commission say a bit more about the committed and the uncommitted reserves and provide examples of reserves being earmarked for specific purposes, and have there been any notable trends in the levels and use of reserves over the recent years, and does the Commission have any concerns about the relatively low levels of uncommitted reserves in some councils?
Again, Blythe is the font of all knowledge in this, so I will pass over to him, but I think it's important that any organisation needs to have some level of reserve to deal with rainy day requirements, to deal with unexpected shocks, to deal with things, for example, dealing with having to decant tenants from a house that's got rack that was unexpected and unplanned for. So having reserves is not a bad thing. That's prudent financial management. The notion that there's a large amount of unutilised and unearmarked reserves is not one that I see. But I'm happy to hand over to Blythe to give a bit more detail behind that.
Yeah, sure. So I think the Commission's been quite consistent in terms of how we've reported on reserves over the last few years. Exhibit 10 in the report offers the sort of flow chart from that headline figure of total usable reserves all the way down to the committed and uncommitted elements. I suppose, in a way to show that actually that headline figure is not really what councils have just got to use as they see fit. So within Exhibit 10, we can see that the uncommitted element of the general fund is 0.46 billion, so 15% of the general fund. That means that a larger proportion is committed for particular purposes. Now, there'll be particular purposes that are mandated by the policy commitments and the nature of the funding, but a lot of that commitment or earmarking is done locally, and it'll be down to councils themselves to decide what works best for them in terms of their own circumstances. So we did do a bit of work in terms of identifying what some of those earmarked funds are and the appropriateness of them and how they sort of fit into to council's general approach to maintaining their financial sustainability. So as you might expect, with 32 individual authorities, they're quite different. The disclosures and the accounts are quite different as well. So in terms of comparability, it's not the easiest task that I've ever done, to put it mildly. But what I would say is that we're seeing a growing trend towards councils taking steps to earmark funds for contingency, which in a way adds to that uncommitted element that we've shown in Exhibit 10 in the report there, so that as much as that's earmarked, it's earmarked for those unexpected events or uneven cash flows that councils can then use that to help them kind of smooth the path, so to speak. I can give you some examples of earmarked funds. Some of them have got really detailed titles, some less so. So, for example, North Ayrshire Council have got a renewal and recovery support fund, so that's worth £13 million. They've also got a fund supporting medium-term financial strategy. So again, that feels quite high level, and the council will then have a bit of control and discretion in terms of how they actually apply that in order to meet the objectives of that financial strategy. They also have earmarked funds, so that kind of could be anything. So again, that sort of vagueness is something that the Commission have reported on quite extensively over the last few years around the transparency of reserves and what they're actually there for, when they're going to be used, what the strategy is for putting them to use, I think will be really, really interesting to help the understanding for the public. A couple more, Western Bartonshire Council, just as another example, have got funds for future pay awards, so that feels quite specific, certainly in comparison to some of the other funds that we've seen. Early retiral voluntary savings schemes, and they've also got a smoothing fund. So again, that's another one that feels a bit like a contingency. There's others that are risk and resilience funds, and you know, I guess, as I say, the point still stands about transparency, and as much as councils have taken pretty significant steps in recent years to improve that transparency in the accounts, it does still feel like there could be more done, as I said, in terms of timing, plans for spend, when some of the funds can enter into the general fund. As you know, clearly we've seen in recent years, particularly around COVID, the late receipt of funds. So funds that come to councils late in the year, they can't actually spend, then they obviously have to be carried forward in reserve. So, there's quite a lot going on with reserves, but hopefully, as I say, in that report, we'll be able to show a bit a clearer picture around what's the kind of uncommitted element and what councils have actually got to fall back on should they require it.
Thank you for that response. I've just got a quick follow-up. Is that okay, Convener? Thanks. Thank you for obviously giving the examples of earmarked funds, but I did ask earlier on about the forecasting, and I know that that's not your role. However, it's to see that basically are councils doing the right thing or what help do they need? But just a question around the reserve side now, how many more years do you think that the council will be able to make up the difference this way before uncommitted reserves run out? Have you done any sort of work around this or taken any data from councils?
So we did do some analysis on that, or loosely related to that, this year as part of the Financial Bulletin 22-23, and it relates to one of the SIPFA Financial Resilience Index indicators, and it's around reserve depletion rates. So we've seen in the past that councils may be at risk of exhausting their usable reserves within a set time frame. That's not necessarily the case just now. The trend is that councils are adding to the reserves, so the analysis that we carried out showed that no council was at risk of fully exhausting the reserves within the next 4 years. So in terms of that warning sign that perhaps you were looking for, that's not something that's come through from our analysis. COVID's had a bit of an impact in terms of the general trend of inflating reserves. So that potentially might skew that analysis ever so slightly. But as I say, no warning sign coming through from that analysis, and that is part of the SIPFA Resilience Index.
Well, thank you for that information. It's just very interesting, me speaking to 31 councils at 32, that they've given me a different picture, speaking to me, talking about how much pressure they have on their reserves and they eventually will run out, and the fact that savings they can't do year to year as they go through, that the savings will have to eventually stop. And you're right, transformational change will have to happen. But just a question on that, Joe, that do you think that the councils are equipped to make those plans to change to the transformational change?
I think that's a very good question, and it's certainly in our best value reporting. We do look at leadership and their abilities to actually identify the strategies and understand how best to implement transformational change opportunities. There is time for that to happen. It's running out, but there is time at the moment. With the reserves picture, I suppose investing in transformational projects, it doesn't happen overnight. But we are asking, and we do get a feel for whether or not that's happening or not. Our reports, when we say we need to increase the pace of change, is an indication that perhaps it's not as fast as it needs to be. Perhaps we need to be slightly more blunt.
I just wanted to... add to that, if that's okay. I think, as Joe says, it's variable. But one of the things, because I think we're talking about risk, and we've talked about debt, and we've talked about reserves, and so warning signs. It's a really complicated picture. So it's not one thing that would give us that, you know, make us concerned about a particular council. So we'd be looking at a variety of things, not only the level of reserves and the trend, the pattern of depletion, as Blythe mentioned. We'd also look at what's their history of delivering their savings targets, their plans, what element or what proportion is recurring versus non-recurring, have they got good medium and longer term financial planning, what's the budget gap, and what's the level of unidentified savings, what bridging actions are they using, what plans have they got going forward for managing that. So that it's kind of a whole bundle of things. There's not one indicator that would say, well, the reserves are low, so we're worried about X council, because those other things are also in the mix. And as Blythe said, the reserve position is really complicated, and what the Commission will be calling for in our next piece of work is that there is more clarity about those reserves, what's committed, what's uncommitted, and what's it committed for, and when, so that we can have a better understanding about how much cushioning there is or isn't. And as you've heard from the chief executives, they're saying that there isn't. But we don't have the detail to be able to confirm that.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Pam. I just want to come back on the earmarked contingency. And you were talking about, Blythe, you were talking about how that it happens at a local level. It's nuanced, really. But I'm just curious about earmark, the idea of a contingency being earmarked, because surely contingency would be contingency unearmarked. Could you say a bit more about the earmarking?
I think I would agree with you. I think that's what I was trying to get across in the answer that I offered. It's difficult for us to know how that's going to be used. The council might have plans beyond that headline of contingency that sits in detail that perhaps doesn't make it to the accounts. But I suppose that, again, just reinforces that message that needs to be a bit clearer. I think you're right that contingency alongside an unallocated amount feels like the same thing. So some analysis that we did do, you'll know that the Commission have recommended that councils hold between 2 and 4% of net revenue expenditure in uncommitted reserves. We found some councils below that this year, which is not always the case. But when we looked at it in a bit more detail, they also had these contingency reserves. So actually, they were sitting above that threshold. So there is a lot of nuance about it, as you correctly point out. But I think it just speaks to the challenge that we have in terms of interrogating the accounts to get the true picture of what reserves look like. So again, we would reinforce that message that transparency could improve.
Okay. Can I just follow up on that? Clearly, coming in as the new chair, and I'm talking about using data to help drive our scrutiny of and reporting on what's happening within local government. Understanding the finances, understanding the budgets is something that I think we need to do a bit more on. But it's also understanding we do not want to add to the scrutiny burden of local government. So it's trying to find the right way through that challenge. Blythe's started down that track. The budget report that's coming out in the next couple of weeks is our first foray into the kind of, OK, what's the current outlook on those budgets for the next 3 years, that gives us comfort that we can say we think the sector's, if not as strong as it could be, it's sufficiently strong for us not to be concerned. But we need to find a way of getting greater transparency about what the budgets, what the numbers are telling us, so that we can give clarity to taxpayers, to council taxpayers, to communities, that their local authority is able to deliver the services it needs without there being a financial challenge facing them.
Mm. That's really helpful. I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie, who's got some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Morning. The Commission notes that spending on unprotected services continues to fall. Have you conducted any assessment as to the impact of these spending cuts, for example, through speaking directly to users of the services?
We do talk to users, and increasingly so, but we haven't actively undertaken a review of what's the impact of the reductions to spending specifically in specific services to specific users. Again, Carol, you can have a bit more detail or more history behind what's going on in that space.
So we've been speaking with the Improvement Service and about the LGBF data to try and work out if there is a correlation with individual services, the spend on those services and the performance of those services. There is not a statistical relationship between the two. It's a much more complicated picture than that. There'll be all sorts of things about demand, need, criteria for services and policy decisions as well, all behind those headline figures. And correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation either, but there is no clear-cut indicators from the LGBF that performance and spend are related. However, having said that, in our last LGO report, where we had a very visual diagram that showed education and social work are being the two services that have had increases in funding over the years, and then all the other services, and I think planning is at the bottom, of having had cuts of around about 30%. Individual councils plan, if you look at individual services and individual councils and track the spend, is you can get a more meaningful relationship. If you try to do that on a global 32 council, because of all those other factors and variables, it becomes meaningless and there isn't a correlation. But looking at individual councils, we can sometimes see that, and that's what the Commission would report in a BV report, if they're showing that those unprotected services, as we kind of phrase them, if those services are showing decreases in performance. The LGBF, the Improvement Service, put out the annual report on the LGBF data this year, and that showed for the first time across all of the indicators that there are more indicators that are declining than there are maintaining or improving, which is the first time that has happened. But that's the kind of global level of all the indicators. Doesn't include any kind of weighting of those indicators or any kind of what's more important to service users and what's more sort of behind the scenes efficiencies about delivering a service. So it's a really, really complicated picture, and the only way you can kind of look at it is by individual service and individual council.
The members have previously heard about service rationing and growing unmet needs. Have you looked at that at all? Has there been any change in that? Is there a trend, a negative trend?
We don't monitor unmet need. Again, unmet needs almost by default difficult to put a figure on because it's difficult to measure. People who don't come forward and ask for a service that's then recorded. So it'd be hard to believe that the cuts to some services, or more importantly, the increasing barrier to access services, would suggest that there's no unmet need, but we don't have a metric at the moment to explain what's the size of that unmet need.
It certainly appears that the bar is being raised to qualify for services, and that would appear to me to hide the unmet need under that.
Again, we can't verify that's happening across all local authorities, but that's anecdotally what we hear. And yes, it would be hard to believe if that bar is getting higher that there's people who previously would have got a service are no longer getting a service. That's definitely clearly a signal of unmet need.
I'm looking at the chart that Carol referred to in respect to the impact on unprotected services over the past 10 years. And yes, planning is certainly the one that's been hit the most. And believe me, I get a lot of complaints about that. But after that is central support services. Now, what would central support services cover? Is it a uniform term across councils?
It would cover things like the finance department, HR, the kind of the back office functions. And they're important functions because what we're finding is that there is a reduction in the capacity in finance departments across Scotland, which makes it more difficult for us to sign off our audits as part of the work that we need to do with those finance departments. Finance capacity is an issue. And I think those services have been cut in order to protect frontline services that people and communities receive, but actually they're important functions, internal controls, all of that work that goes on behind the scenes to make sure that there's good financial management.
I suppose looking at this bar chart, it's based on percentages, which doesn't really give you a feel as to, you know, how much money is behind this. Looking at the financing of these would give us an idea of the impact, greater maybe than a percentage. Culture and leisure have been particularly hard hit too. And I suppose, would that be libraries and so on?
Yes, libraries, cultural, you know, museums, swimming pools, leisure centres, that sort of thing, yeah. Mm.
There have also been reductions in capital budgets, which obviously service users have sustained. What's the impact of that been, the reduction on the capital budgets? Are there any groups of users that might be more greatly impacted by reduced capital budgets?
Well, reduced capital budgets means that there's less money to maintain and build new assets. So roads, for instance, schools, maintenance of other community buildings and assets. So when there's a cut to the budget, those properties are not being maintained to the same level. And I think we all know from the state of the roads that they're not being maintained to the level that we would expect. So capital budget does have an impact. Cuts to capital budget does have an impact on the infrastructures.
Mm. Has the Commission made any assessment of how these capital budget reductions are impacting on local government's net zero ambitions?
I don't think so. No. I don't think there is. We are doing work on net zero, but it's not work I'm involved in, so I wouldn't be able to confidently answer that question, Mr. Coffey, I'm afraid.
I mean, does the Accounts Commission now take net zero into account when it's doing its audits?
We certainly look at the environmental sustainability requirements of local authorities, yes. The extent to which capital budgets affect the net zero plans or aspirations is significant, and it will presumably push out the date at which those are deliverable. But we don't have clarity around exactly when, what plans are, and therefore the timing effect of a cut in the budget to whether it's going to be bringing it forward or pushing it further back.
So who is monitoring the net zero progress in terms of local government?
Andrew.
Thanks, Colin. It's a really important question. There are a series of performance audits, as we call them, that the Accounts Commission with Audit Scotland support are undertaking that look at net zero targets and whether they're being achieved. But I think, as Joe and Carol have already said, I'm not aware that we've had any direct link between reductions in capital and its impact on net zero, and certainly it's something that we can take on board, given your line of questioning. But just to reassure you, there are this series of performance audits that are currently looking at net zero targets and achievement thereof or not, and much of that work is referenced on the Audit Scotland / Accounts Commission website. But as I say, I'm not aware of a direct sort of look at reduction in capital and its impact, but it's something we can certainly take away and consider.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Joe, I wonder if I could ask you for some views on the Verity House Agreement and particularly the monitoring and accountability framework that's planned. It sits alongside other frameworks, national performance framework, local government benchmark framework. How does the Accounts Commission see these all working together, or is there any better way of consolidating these various frameworks to give us a single picture?
I mean, that's an interesting idea that there ought to be interlinked. They really ought to be interlinked. The extent to which we are actively involved in discussions about what the Verity House Agreement is going to be and how we might get involved are limited because they haven't come forward with anything. We've signalled that we are very interested in being supportive of what comes out. We don't want to be actively involved in developing it because we're in danger then of marking our own homework. But we definitely want to be involved in helping act as that independent arbiter on accountability and allow both sides then to think, actually, yeah, we might be ceding control in one side or another, but we know that there's an independent auditor, independent assurance system in place that gives us comfort that by ceding control or ceding ownership of maybe the monies, that we will get the outcomes that we have collectively agreed to sign up to. But we await to see what comes out of that. Mm.
You don't have a direct role in trying to shape and assist and develop
that? We've decided not to, Willie, on the grounds that, as I say, if we do that, we end up marking our own homework. So we haven't gone in that space. Andrew, is anything you want to pick up?
Yeah, no, I mean, just to amplify that, Willie, the Chair's right. I mean, we can't get involved in, obviously, the detailed workings of how the Verity House Agreement commitments are delivered or not delivered, because we would then thereafter be, as Joe said, be in danger of potentially looking at our own work. But it's a really important line of questioning, because it's crucial to say that the Commission has been very welcoming of the fact that the Verity House Agreement was signed last year. And I know you may be coming on to this, but the fact I've just said last year is the crucial point to make, that it's over 12 months now since the agreement was signed. And I'm pretty sure everybody in the room would recognise the fact that we're less... I mean, there's a lot of focus on the UK election just now, upcoming, but we're less than 2 years away from the short campaign of the next Holyrood election. There's a decreasing window of opportunity to finalise the details of the Verity House Agreement, in particular the development of a fiscal framework, which will be behind a lot of potential solution to the problems we've been discussing already this morning. And the closer we get to May 2026, I think the Commission would contest, I think hopefully everybody in the room would agree, that there's less chance of a consensual agreement around the fiscal framework. The further away we are from May 2026, the more chance we have of a consensual agreement. So we would really encourage the Government and COSLA to make progress on this. I mean, I know the Government gave an update to us and to the committee, I think, in December, in writing, I think it was, and that was to be welcomed. But that was now 4 months ago, and we as a Commission have heard both government ministers, I'm sure you have as well, and COSLA presidential team say that they want to get this right and not rush it and get it wrong. That's totally understandable, but time is becoming of the essence, and the Commission would really urge progress on particularly the fiscal framework within the Verity House Agreement.
OK, thanks very much for that, Andrew. I wonder if I could turn to a favourite question that this committee poses on ring fencing and directed funding and all the terminology that surrounds that. It sounds a little bit like the reserves debate earlier, with multiple categories here and there. But you've got a figure of 26% is your guess about what ring fencing and directed funding actually is, the amount that it is. But if you talk to the Scottish Government, it could be as low as 10%, but if you talk to COSLA, it could be 60%. Joe, could you offer a wee flavour of why these discrepancies are there, these huge differences in figures are there, and possibly explain to the committee and hopefully members of the public why these differences are there?
Again, I will ask Blythe to come in a bit more detail, but I think strategically, the ring fencing debates have run around what's included in the baseline and what's not included in the baseline. And as soon as you add something to a baseline, the percentage change you get can be significant or not. So the Verity House Agreement and the fiscal framework, we would hope, would give greater clarity and certainty on both sides of what is included in a ring fence pot and what's not. And if you have it in, then the percentage change is an obvious arithmetic calculation. The differences in between the Scottish Government's assessment, our assessment and COS assessment is what's in and what's not in that baseline figure. Sorry, Lucy.
In our Exhibit 5 from last year's local government overview, we attempted to illustrate the differing views and how we came to our number that is between the two of them. So the Scottish Government would view ring fencing as purely those funds in the specific resource grant. COSLA take a different view, which is all of the specific resource grant plus any obligations created by current or past policy initiatives from the Scottish Government. So that would be things that including all school teaching staff, because numbers are mandated, as well as a large amount of adult social care, where the costs are devolved to the IJB. So their estimate is closer to kind of 65-70%. Our calculation is, as a starting point, it's the specific revenue grant, and then we look through the budget documents, all revisions plus the financial circulars, and look for lines where funding has been directed to specific policies. So ours is ring fence plus directed funding, and when you add up all those elements, we get to a total for 22-23, it was 26%, so that's a small increase on the year before. But yes, that is how we get to our calculation, which obviously differs from the other two. But
That's really helpful, Lucy. Does the Scottish Government and the COSLA agree with your method of analysis of this?
I think it's a sad indictment that we end up having to have this debate every year.
Yep.
Ring fencing and the debate about what's in and what's not in.
Yep.
It would be much better if we could actually have that effort directed at how do we make transformation of change work, rather than having to defend and redefend and reassess numbers. That would be my kind of plea at this stage, because it's every year there's a discussion about what percentage is ring fenced and what's not.
Yeah, I look forward to that day.
Well, I just want to come in there. I mean, is that something that we can, you know, we've got the fiscal framework in development, so you would like to think that within that framework there's,
yes,
an alignment around,
correct,
what we're talking,
correct,
about here.
Absolutely.
And that becomes,
yeah,
really important, yeah, isn't it?
Yeah, Lucy.
In the most recent budget for 24-25, there was actually positive movements in that the specific revenue grant decreased hugely, and some of that was baselined into the general resource grant. But I suppose on the other side of that coin is we may still class that as directed funding, even though it is within the general revenue grant.
Okay, a bit more work to be done there. Willie, got more questions?
Just a final question for me on the council tax freeze. Joe, as you know, the Scottish Government provided £147 million to the councils to freeze the council tax, plus another £63 million through Barnett consequentials, making a total of £210 million. But there's a comment in your report that says freezing the council tax suppresses the growth of the council tax base over the particular period, and the income generated when the fees is lifted is potentially lower. I wonder if you could explain to the members what we mean, what the Commission means by that.
I will give you my interpretation of what I think we wrote, and if I've got it wrong, somebody can jump in and tell me I'm wrong. If you don't increase your baseline by an amount and it's not guaranteed in the future years, then you're starting off next year with a lower baseline on which to then increase your, on which to levy your taxes. So if you want to raise tax levels by a certain amount year on year, you've got certainty on what your baseline is if you've increased your council tax year on year. If you can't guarantee that budget allocation year on year, then your baseline is a smaller amount. And I probably haven't... Have I given the correct answer, Blythe?
Perfect.
He has to say that, doesn't he? Yeah.
Okay.
Does that help you?
Yes,
really?
It certainly does. With that explanation, though, why would the councils choose to freeze the council tax then if, by your estimation, they could actually generate more income in future years by not freezing it?
Well, clearly not involved in the debate and discussions behind the scenes between Scottish Government and local government as to why they chose to freeze it if they could have increased it. Clearly there's been some interesting debates within some councils as to whether or not they should have increased it, but all have accepted the council tax freeze as a starting point.
OK, I'll leave that one at that. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, William. And I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. So we've spoken a little bit already about budget transparency, and I'm quite interested in the public engagement part of that as well. So just to quote from your report, the Commission says that it's important the councils are clear with the public about their finances and have frank conversations about what services they can realistically provide. So I'm wondering what it was that led to the Commission making that recommendation.
It slightly predates me, so I'm not going to prejudge exactly what was in somebody's mind when they wrote that, but I'm pretty sure it's around if we are having to cut services, are we having to ration services, then there has to be an explanation to the communities as to why that's happening. So greater transparency about how budgets are being allocated, how services are being provided, increases the potential for at least communities accepting, if not liking, what the outcome is. Am I correct? And is that that was the justification?
Yeah, I think we've said it in the past in the local government overview a few times that councils need to have honest conversations with the communities, because basically we're asking communities what's the least worst scenario here. So those are very difficult conversations to have. And even when councils have consulted on their budgets, the reality of something closing or a service being withdrawn still is very difficult to swallow. So there's a lot of barriers. You can say things conceptually, but when it actually happens, there's a lot of resistance to changing, to reducing services and shutting schools and shutting community centres and all of that. And I suppose what we're trying to say is that there has to be a realistic conversation, that it is about what's least worst scenario in these cases. And they are difficult conversations to have with communities. And it's difficult for elected members to vote on those decisions as well, because they want to be voted back in too, and it is against what communities want. But those are the hard choices that are being made at the moment, and they're very difficult. Even when councils, as I say, have done really good consultation on their budget, we still see examples across Scotland where there have been U-turns on decisions that have been made because of the public outcry.
So have you done some work then that's actually exploring then how councils are communicating and engaging with the public, and also whether that's really making an impact and influencing the decisions that are made?
Yes, in the individual BV reports on individual councils, we'll look at community engagement, and it's not just about consultation, it's also about empowerment. So to what extent are communities involved in the decision-making processes around delivery of services? So we would cover that on an individual basis through best value reports.
So I suppose that kind of brings me on to my next question as well. We're 10 years on from Christie and the vision that built there as well. So I'm quite interested in as well the programmes, the transformation that we've had over recent years too, and what it is that actually leads to successful transformation. So I'm wondering, have you got an example, a good example of transformation that's gone really well, and what the kind of key reasons are that they've come out this better than others, if you like?
I will hand over to Carol, because that's definitely more informed than me at this stage, but I do think it's about leadership. It's about showing leadership and thinking strategically about what's needed, but that leadership then has to drive through the change necessary. And that's a challenge when you're actually just having to maintain services on a day-to-day basis. Carol?
Yeah, I can pick up on that. But can I first apologise to Mr Beattie for calling Mr Coffey earlier in the discussion? I realised immediately, and I've been trying to get in an apology. Sorry about that. So transformation, have we seen any examples? The last local government overview report had a supplementary document alongside it, which covered a number of case studies where we've seen small-scale transformation in individual services and individual councils. So there is a lot of work that's going on that's quite small-scale. What I would also say is to reflect back on when we came to the committee after the pandemic, about what was it about the pandemic that enabled councils to be so fleet of foot and changing the way that they delivered services. And what we said at that point was that we're using data very well to focus resources on need. There was collaborative leadership that was driving forward on a common purpose. And there were new ways, very flexible, new ways of governance and also using the workforce. Those things still apply. What we've also said in our local government overviews is that we need to also be working with the workforce and about planning what the workforce should look like in the future. These are all long, medium and long-term goals. So I think at the moment, because the financial situation is so challenging, councils are focusing on the immediate, keeping the show on the road, making efficiencies, running services. And as one of my colleagues, which I'll shamelessly steal from, will say, it's really difficult to overhaul the aeroplane when you're flying it. So, and that is, you know, I think that's quite a good metaphor, really, for what we're asking councils to do right now. And I'll refer back to the Solus document, where they do set out what is a new paradigm for local government. What are we about? What should we be doing as guardians of place and enabling services to be provided, but not necessarily being the delivery body for those services? To get to that place, there are barriers. And those barriers are things like having the community agree and come along with you, having the unions and the workforce understanding and agreeing coming along with you, having the elected members making those decisions and coming along with you, along with everything we've talked about in terms of financial flexibility and being able to plan for the long term. So that's some of the barriers that gets in the way of the bigger change that we are saying is needed.
So I wonder then if you could give a kind of quite specific example then, and perhaps touch on that partnership working and the empowerment in communities that's kind of going along with that.
From memory, I think South Ayrshire have been quite good at that kind of community engagement and delivering things differently. There's a lot of information on the Improvement Service website. There's also the supplement I referred to on our website. And I just turn to colleagues in case they've got any other examples on the tip of their tongue that they want to throw in.
No, I think South Ayrshire is the one specific local authority that we've seen referenced in some of the individual BV work that we've looked at, Stephanie, and is the one that I would, on behalf of the Commission, direct members to have a look at. It's done some really innovative stuff that has saved significant sums of money.
And is that tied into early intervention and prevention as well then? Just the fact that you're talking about saving sums of money going forward?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's tied into the points that Carol was making about significant and deep community engagement at an early stage, so involving local residents, you know, participants who have got a stake in the service that's been delivered or potentially transformed, that South Ayrshire's got a record of doing that at a very early stage in a deep and meaningful way, which doesn't apply to all local authorities. It is very, very difficult, not under play in that, but South Ayrshire does have a good record of doing that in recent years.
Okay. That's great. Thanks, Convener. And I should probably put on record as well that I was a local councillor at South Lancashire Council until 2022.
Thanks very much. I just wanted to pursue that transformational change strand a little bit more. A few things. One, you know, we understand from our work on the Community Empowerment Act that Scotland has a community empowerment agenda, and obviously the community planning partnerships were set up through that piece of legislation. And then we've been looking at the National Planning Framework, which has brought forward the idea of communities creating local place plans. So you've got one vehicle which is about the kind of built environment, and another one which is more about delivery of certain services. But also we're beginning to do work around the whole community wealth building agenda. So I just wonder if there are tools in place that could support the transformational change that we're, you know, need sprucing up or just a kind of looking at. I mean, it is interesting also that the Verity House Agreement does point to the community planning partnerships as some kind of vehicle for supporting things to happen. Maybe it's transformational change. So I just wonder what your thoughts are in there, in that, and how we can support local authorities to maybe be looking in those directions for that transformational change.
Again, my experience on this is more limited. Carol, is there anything you wanted to pick up specifically on that?
I think in terms of the Solace Transformation projects, there are a number of anchors that, as they describe them, and one of them is about community action. There is another that's specifically looking at partnership working and systems thinking, so place thinking. And another one is about design for needs. So again, so that's bringing data in again. So I think these are all things that, well, I know that these are all things that the sector are looking at to draw on to enable them to make the transformational change that is required. So I think there's a good understanding of what to do and how to do it. But I think some of the barriers that I referred to earlier are kind of getting in the way of that. And the Verity House Agreement is one thing that might help smooth that passage of making those changes.
Is there something I heard in a conversation was the idea that can we get to the place where communities are actually leading with councils kind of supporting and facilitating that more nuanced local need and then developers coming in to then deliver what communities are looking for, whereas at the moment what we seem to have is developers, especially around housing, but now we're talking about placemaking much more, and thank you for bringing that in. Can we kind of like turn that around so that instead of developers identifying the land and saying this is where things are going, this is where things need to happen, it's actually communities coming and saying these are the needs we see, and then that more kind of facilitation. I mean, you do talk about the Solace report talking about that partnership working. So I guess that's what it is, but it's the emphasis, right? Who leads and how do we get to the point where communities really have that sense of agency that they can lead in the first place?
That's exactly what Solace are getting at there. I think it's they talk about unlocking community action and they refer to being delivery agnostic. Mm-hmm. So it is much more about empowering communities. I guess in the current climate, it might be that empowering communities to do things for themselves sounds like councils cutting services. So I think there's a sell that needs to be made around all of that. But yes, that is what Solace as the sector as a whole are looking at in terms of the way forward.
Okay. On that note of transformational change, I want to say thanks so much for joining us this morning. It's been a very, very constructive, very informative session. So really appreciate that. And it's been great to have you, Joe, along for this first session with the committee, and look forward to seeing you in the future. And I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of our witnesses. We'll now begin our stage two proceedings on the Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill. And we're joined for this item by the Minister for Housing and his officials, Graham Simpson, MSP, and Pam Duncan-Glancy, MSP. And I'd like to briefly explain the procedure we'll be following during today's proceedings for anyone watching. So members should have with them a copy of the bill as introduced and also the marshalled list of amendments, which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be disposed of, and also the groupings of amendments, which sets out the amendments in the order in which they'll be debated. And these documents are available on the bill webpage on the Scottish Parliament's website for anybody observing. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. In each debate, I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in the group to speak to and move the amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I will then call other members with amendments in the group to speak, but not to move their amendments and to speak to other amendments in the group if they wish. And then at my discretion, I will call any other members who wish to speak in the debate. Members wishing to speak should indicate by catching me or my clerk's attention. I will then call the minister if he has not already spoken in the debate. And finally, I will call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up and to indicate whether he or she wishes to press the amendment or withdraw it. If the amendment is pressed, I will put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in the group are not debated again when they are reached, and if they are moved, I will put the question on them straight away. If a member wishes to withdraw an amendment after it has been moved and debated, I will ask whether any member present objects. If there is an objection, I will immediately put the question on the amendment. If any member does not wish to move their amendment when it is called, they should say not moved. In this situation, any other member present may move the amendment. If no one wishes to move it, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. If there is a division, only committee members are entitled to vote. Voting is by a show of hands, and it's important that members keep their hands raised clearly until the clerk has recorded their names. The committee is also required to consider and decide on each section and schedule of the bill and the long title, and I will put the question on each of these provisions at the appropriate point. And it's our intention to complete stage two scrutiny of the bill today. So with that, I'd like to begin with the first grouping, which is around cladding assurance, the cladding assurance register, additional work assessments, and levels of risk. And I call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. And I point out that if Amendment 10 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 44 or 45 due to preemption. Minister, to move Amendment 10 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, I'll begin this group by speaking to Government Amendments 10, 11, and 12, and my name is currently drafted. Part 1 of the bill outlines a requirement for Scottish ministers to maintain a cladding assurance register. An entry will only be created in the register after a single building assessment has been completed and any remediation work identified in that SBA has been completed to the satisfaction of ministers. This was to ensure that entries were only made once remediation work identified in the SBA, if any, has been completed. However, I acknowledge that during Stage 1 evidence sessions conducted by this committee, numerous stakeholders highlighted the multifaceted challenges associated with properties affected by potentially unsafe cladding, with issues pertaining to remortgaging, buying, selling and insuring such properties of particular concern. The Stage 1 report issued by the committee highlighted that there were concerns about the existing points of entry in the cladding assurance register might not adequately address these challenges, and that there was a growing consensus among stakeholders supporting the point of entry onto the register has always been the completion of a single building assessment, including where a need of remediation work is identified. I made a commitment to review the Government's position on any point of entry, in my response to the Committee's Stage 1 report on the bill. After careful consideration, I agree that changing the entry point for buildings into the cladding assurance register in cases where the SBA identifies a need for remediation work would be a worthwhile change. This approach seems to seeks to enhance transparency and may assist decision-making in property transactions, whilst ensuring any change is aligned with the overarching objective of ensuring the safety and well-being of occupants residing in the buildings with cladding. It responds positively and directly to a recommendation made by the committee in its Stage 1 report. This change is delivered by Amendments 10-11, which will ensure that an entry into the register is always created immediately after the SB has been completed. This change creates a need to adjust Section 1 to be as clear as how the completion of works is then recorded. Government Amendment 12 does this by confirming that an entry is to be updated as soon as reasonably practical after Scottish ministers are satisfied that the work is complete. But Amendment 12 has an additional aspect to which I will now turn. The other impact of Amendment 12 is that, along with remaining government amendments in this group, adds the concept of additional work assessments onto the bill. Our approach to cladding remediation is centred on the process of a single building assessment, and specifically the works required to eliminate or mitigate risk to human life related to the external wall system. Cladding assessment and remediation can be a complex engineering project. We must allow for a scenario where additional relevant risk and associated works to address this risk are identified after a single building assessment has been completed without going back to square one. For example, this could occur where an issue becomes apparent after a cladding panel has been removed from a building during the course of planned remediation and exposes a problem that was not evident in the original SBA. We do not want to create any unnecessary barriers of process which would delay the completion of necessary work. Through these amendments, we are also seeking to ensure that all required works are documented, completed and captured in the cladding assurance register, ensuring that the golden thread of information from assessment to completed remediation is maintained. We must also ensure that rights of owners are protected and may have therefore reflected existing procedural safeguards, including 21 days notification and appeal against newly discovered work being conducted unless the work is urgent. I ask members to support all the government amendments in this group. Convener, I now want to move on to the non-government amendments, and I'll turn first of all to Mark Griffin's amendments in this group. These amendments seek to amend the language of the bill, specifically in relation to a risk to human life, and in doing so they touch on the central purpose of the bill, and indeed of the cladding remediation programme itself. As such, Mark Griffin's amendments propose changes in a number of places throughout the bill, but we are required to discuss here due to amendments 44 and 45 being preempted in my amendment 10, which I've already discussed. My assumption is that Mark Griffin's amendments are taken together to intended to replace the current references to risks, which are directly or indirectly created or exacerbated by a building's external wall cladding system, with broader references to any risk created or exacerbated by that system. I do not support such an approach. The current language makes clear the risk to be addressed may either be directly caused by the cladding system itself or indirectly influenced by it. Not being clear on this point could risk narrowing the focus of the single building assessment to risks directly attributed to the cladding system alone, potentially overlooking secondary or indirect risks that impact on the risk to life. Such narrowing of the assessment could ultimately have the effect of leaving remediated buildings at higher risk level post-remediation than the bill currently allows for. I urge Mark Griffin not to move these amendments as they may increase the risk to owners and occupiers in affected areas. I want to touch to the final amendment, which is 49 in the group, in the name of Miles Brigg. This amendment seeks to remove Section 1A3B from the bill. This section relates to the cladding assurance register and specifically the ability of Scottish ministers to include in any register any information that they consider appropriate. In addition to that, required to be included by paragraph A of Section 1.3, and if my amendment 12 is agreed to, new paragraphs AA and AB. The government's intention with existing provision is to retain flexibility in terms of what can be added to the register to allow us to add further information to the register if required, as the cladding assurance register is operationalised. I've already committed to working with stakeholders such as ABI and UK Finance to ensure the register can be up to maximum value to them to consider their ability to lend on and insure properties with potentially unsafe cladding. It is imperative that we have the ability to capture the data that will allow the register to operate as effectively as possible. While I can appreciate there's certainly that certainty as to what can be added as an attractive prospect and unbalanced, the government position is to retain that flexibility. I urge Miles Briggs not to move this amendment. In conclusion, convener, I ask the members do not move the amendments in this group, and I move Amendment 10 in my name.
Thank you. Mark Griffin to speak to Amendment 44 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks, convener. I have a number of amendments in this group which are all probing amendments. At this point, and I appreciate the engagement with the Minister ahead of Stage 2 and into Stage 3 as we look toward finalising the bill. But Essentially, all of these amendments in this particular group, as the Minister said, change the language in the bill so that it clarifies that issues raised through the single building assessment must link it directly into life critical risk. But taking account of the Minister's points, I'm happy not to move these amendments and continue discussions towards stage three.
Thank you. And Miles Briggs to speak to Amendment 49 and all other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. It's only Amendment 49 in this group for myself, which again is a probing amendment, and specifically to look at what the Minister's outlined, which for developers is important, which is clarification of what works will need to be undertaken, the cladding and the detail which will be on the cladding assurance register beyond the single building assessment. And my specific concern was in relation to additional information which might come forward with regard to the orphan buildings and that then presenting a potential delay in works for funding these. So just wondered if that is a specific issue the Minister has taken any advice on, and whether or not this does then create a situation, given the limited funds which are already being highlighted for works on orphan buildings, that more and more information coming forward potentially would limit the scope of government taking forward works on orphan buildings. I think for those of us who represent people living in these buildings, that's something we do not want to see.
Come back.
I'll just see if anyone else wants to come in, and then you can. I'll bring you in for winding up. And you can speak there. Anyone else want to speak? Okay, Minister, if you'd like to come in.
Yeah. I mean, it's something obviously we've spoken to ABI and UK Finance on as well about that particular point. And I think it comes back to the point that Mark Griffin had mentioned as well. And we've had discussions all the way through the process, and we'll continue to do so in terms of that. And I think we had a quick chat yesterday talking about that and all the way through the process. So happy to pick up that particular point with you in that regard. But we have had discussions with stakeholders on that regard.
Okay. Given we're at stage two, I think it is important that we do have clarification over some of that, especially for orphan buildings, and maybe at stage three, although these aren't being looked at in two separate categories, I think it is important we do try to make sure there is clarification that these buildings are supported. So happy not to move this amendment at stage two, but would appreciate engagement ahead of stage three.
Yeah, right to you on that particular matter.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much. Anything else in winding up, Minister?
Nothing further to add.
Thank you. I remind members that if Amendment 10 is agreed, I cannot call Amendment 44 or 45 due to preemption. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed. I call Amendment 46 in the name of Mark Griffin. We're going to move now on to the next group, which is around single building assessment, content, definition, effect. And I call Amendment 46 in the name of Mark Griffin, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Mark Griffin to move Amendment 46 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. I move Amendment 46 in my name. Again, the amendments I have in this group are of a probing nature, and they were to essentially get more detail as per the evidence that we got at stage one about what a single building assessment would look like and some of the content around that. But again, welcome the discussion I've had with the Minister in advance and continuing into stage three on the design of what a single building assessment will look like. On Amendment 46, this amendment would provide a start point where discussions could take place based on the report. The SBA should produce and highlight the products used in the context of a ban. By mandating that this data is made available, Parliament would then be able to scrutinise the process and make sure that the Scottish context and PAS is not used to allow combustible materials to remain in situ on buildings over 11 metres. This amendment would require a Scottish Building Assessment to include information on the type of products present and their Euroclass ratings. Amendment 53, where the bill is focused on the key concept of a single building assessment as outlined in the explanatory notes, with so much of the process then hanging on that key concept, I think it's then essential that all parties impacted by this have full clarity at the outset as to what a Scottish Building Assessment is, its specification, what it looks like, and what standards it's assessing to. Now, none of that detail is provided in this legislation, and I think it is a really important detail that we should define. We should give people more clarity, both from the developers and the resident side, as to the details that should be contained within that assessment. On Amendment 82...
Take an intervention on that point.
Yep, that's, I will.
Thanks. I was just reading Amendment 53, which says that each single building assessment report must state who is responsible for carrying out any remediation work. And I just wonder the sort of level of detail you mean by that. Are you identifying companies or the type of tradesperson or... You know, what is it you're driving at in that?
Thanks, Mr. Simpson, for that intervention. It's not, the company or tradesperson who would be responsible for carrying out the physical work, but purely the organisation, the corporate body who would be responsible for commissioning, inspecting and ensuring that work was up to an appropriate standard. That's the reference in Amendment 53. On Amendment 82, similar to Amendment 53, that amendment provides more detail on responsibility for works required that are highlighted within the single building assessment. Amendment 83, the current guidance in Scotland doesn't allow for a tolerable risk in buildings. Therefore, every element included within the scope of the single building assessment can only be categorised as high or no risk. And so by implication, that means that most developments over 11 metres will potentially then default to solely high risk. And again, this was an issue that we took evidence on at stage two, that could potentially make things worse for homeowners, even if there are no life-critical issues requiring remediation. And this amendment sets out to remedy that by including a further category of risk defined as tolerable. On Amendment 84, this amendment will ensure that information on the type of products present and their Euroclass ratings would be included on a building's entry in the cladding assurance register, which would be publicly available. And that would allow scrutiny of the SBA process and an understanding of the types of material used in the external facades of the buildings in question. More generally, that it follows along a number of written questions that I've lodged on the SBA process and essentially looking for more detail up front for residents, and those would be responsible for scrutinising potential properties that they might be looking to move into. Finally, Convener, Amendment 85. The bill provides a specific definition of the height of buildings to fall within scope, but the wording of the bill allows that this would be amended by regulations at a future date, including for buildings at a lower height than 11 metres. For consistency, this amendment stops the government being able to alter the height of buildings which fall under the legislation and allows the cladding bill's height specification to be aligned to existing regulations and the Building Scotland Amendment Regulations 22, which stipulate not including rooftop plant areas or any story consisting exclusively of plant rooms at a height of 11 metres or more above the ground. And that concludes my remarks. I look forward to the government's response to those amendments.
Thank you. Can I confirm that you're moving Amendment 46?
Yeah, 46 moved.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 51 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Good morning to the Minister and others too. The amendments that I have in my name in this group and indeed in other groups are intended to address some of the issues that I've heard from residents who live in the Glasgow region in particular, but also, I have no doubt, across the rest of Scotland. Amendment 51 in my name introduces an oversight and advisory committee on the continued development and improvement of single building assessments. Amendment 52 in my name creates an independent reviewer tasked with approving the key stages of the development of a single building assessment. And Amendment 86 is, I suppose, what you'd call rather a tidying amendment that ensures Timmy's setting up of the committee in Amendment 51. Residents, particularly in Glasgow, but as I say, probably across the rest of the country, have felt quite distanced in some cases from the development of single building assessments and processes. Residents' associations have raised concern with me about a conflict of interest for buildings with dangerous cladding in the region, and they believe that occupier and owner voices in the process is essential to balancing that conflict. I share that view. Occupier and owner voice is essential in the single building assessment development process to ensure transparency in a system of checks and balances. And amendments, therefore, in this group, in developing those, I consider that the government must include owners, occupiers and representatives within the development of the building assessments. 51 creates a specific committee for single building assessments and requires people to be consulted by ministers in the continued improvement and development of the single building assessment under Part 2 of the legislation. It means that where problems with the SBA system are identified, the committee could consult with the ministers and the required changes could be made. The amendment provides membership of the committee, includes owners and occupiers, buildings covered by the legislation, in buildings covered by the legislation, as well as organisations that represent them. And it also says that ministers will have the ability to identify other members of the committee as it considers appropriate. Further, there's a requirement on the ministers in Amendment 51 to try, insofar as reasonably possible, to include disabled people and representative organisations on that committee, given the number of disabled people who died during the Grenfell tragedy. Amendment 55, further to Amendment 51, again, is because residents raise concern on the current plans for developers only to create the single building assessment. And their view is that it creates a conflict of interest. And I am too worried about that. Current plans mean that the developers responsible for constructing buildings are now potentially chiefly responsible for ascertaining whether those buildings are a fire risk. So Amendment 52 creates an independent reviewer that's responsible for approving the arrangement of the single building assessment, the single building assessment report, and any subsequent works identified by it. It's my view, and that of residents in the buildings that I've consulted, that this would add transparency and voice to the process. Scottish ministers would have the power to determine the necessary expertise of that reviewer. However, I suggest that it should be an expert relevant to the issue we're facing, fire safety and building development, of course. Both are essential to ensuring the reviewer can adequately address the fire risks identified in the building assessment. And that amendment introduces, in my opinion, checks and balances and transparency to the current proposed system. Put simply, Convener and others, Amendments 51 and 55 give occupiers and owners a voice in the development of the single building assessment, seek to address the concerns that were raised by me, by residents to me, about the potential conflict of interest. And I believe that this could alleviate many of their concerns over potentials of developers being solely responsible for it. I think it adds the checks and balances necessary, and I hope that the government would be minded to support it. As I said earlier, Amendment 86 is a tidying amendment and ensures that the committee is up and running in a timeous time according to the legislation and the commencement of it. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. And just to note that, just for clarity, Amendment 55 is not in this group. It's a rustling of papers there. Minister to speak to Amendment 42 and other amendments in the group.
Yeah, just on that point, I think, Convener, I'll touch on that when we move to that group, if that's okay.
Of course.
Nothing I'd say in terms of that. I'd noticed that myself in terms of that. So, starting with Amendment 46, the Cladding Insurance Register is designed to provide a reliable source of information on the condition of relevant buildings, including information on what remediation work, if any, that the SBA states must take place in respect of a building. The SBA itself will contain information on types of cladding in use in a building. It is possible that the register entry in relation to remediation works, if any, required in relation to any specific building, could potentially refer to types of cladding used in that building, whereas this was relevant to the entry on remediation works. We do not consider it would be benefit to include within the register this type of cladding being used in the property as proposed in Amendment 46. Cladding will not always be removed from a building in entirety as part of its remediation work to bring the building up to a tolerable risk level. There is therefore a risk that providing information on the types of cladding in use in a specific building could work to the detriment of homeowners, where insurers or mortgage providers to use that information to refuse to insure or to lend on a building on a blanket basis when the SBA has been concluded that the presence of a degree of cladding within a building is acceptable in that context. I therefore invite Mark Griffin to withdraw this amendment and ask members to reject it if the amendment is pressed. And moving on to Amendment 50. Yeah, of course.
Thank you. I just want to ask the Minister, I think Mr Griffin here is simply asking in his amendment that owners or indeed occupiers are given the fullest amount of information on what their property is actually built of. So is that not reasonable? I mean, is the Minister surely not arguing that that is unreasonable?
No, I think in terms of the process. I think they do have that information, and in my opinion, they do have that information. So happy again to pick at that. And you know, I think Brother Chapman, Mr Griffin, talk about the SBA process and when that's fully completed. But in my opinion, I think we've got the process in place. As you will know, and I think discussed this with yourself, Mr Simpson, the SBA process is still working with developers and stakeholders at the moment. That's due to complete by the end of May, so hopefully to come back to committee on that particular point. But at this stage, I think we've got the process in place to deal with that. Coming back, if it's okay, convener, just to move on. I want to move on to Amendment 52 and now turn to Amendment 52, which proposes the creation of an independent reviewer to bring a degree of independent insurance to the assessment and remediation process. I do not disagree with the principle of ensuring appropriate checks and balances are in place to protect owners and residents, but I would ask committee members to consider the relevant measures we've already built into the bill. Whether a single building assessment is carried out as instructed by Scottish ministers or a developer, it must be carried out in accordance with the standards specified by Scottish ministers and by a person authorised by Scottish ministers. This ensures not only a consistent approach to assessment, but that it is always completed by a suitably qualified and competent individual, for example, a fire engineer with professional registration. Additionally, works... Yeah? Yep.
I thank the Minister for taking that intervention. And before I go to that point, just to clarify, the arguments that I made earlier were for 51 and 52. I got my 52 and 55 mixed up, but not the arguments, hopefully. So hopefully that was clear. The point that the provisions in the bill, I think, currently allow a situation whereby a developer has almost sole control over the single building assessment in a particular development. That's something that residents have been particularly concerned about. And so I'd ask the Minister to comment on which aspects of the bill before us today would mitigate that concern from residents.
I've got a little bit more to say, Candy, on that one, and happy to pick up that particular point. I think, and I'll move on just in terms of this just now and hopefully pick up the points that you mentioned. Works will only be considered when the cladding insurance register is updated accordingly, and again will require that works have been completed to the satisfaction of Scottish ministers. Work is now underway to develop a robust compliance and assurance framework to support this within the cladding remediation programme, which I think kind of touches on the point that you referenced, Mr Duncan Clancy, and I think in terms of where the SBA process and how that completes, again, is something happy to come back to you further on that particular point. But I think in terms of where the process is going, that will pick up the particular points that you have. Last, I would remind members that we also seek to undertake works with consent of owners, and if this is not possible, they have a right of appeal to the Sheriff Court, other than circumstances where work is considered so urgent that the risk of life is immediate, in which case such notice as the circumstances will permit will be given. I do not believe that an independent review is necessary in light of the measures I've outlined, and that's why I ask members to reject this amendment if it's moved. We must avoid unnecessary delays in progressing with both assessment and remediation. I want to move on to Amendments 53 and 82. And assigning responsibility for remediation work is not part of the SBA and not an appropriate task for the experts undertaking these assessments. The purpose of the SBA is to comprehensively assess the risk to human life that is either directly or indirectly created or exacerbated by a building's external wall cladding system. The attribution of responsibility for remediation work will be done after the work is identified in the SBA, when contractors to carry out the remediation will be engaged. I consider that these amendments would distract from the purpose of the SBA rather than improve the bill. I therefore ask members to reject these amendments in the event that they're moved. I want to move on to amendments 51 and 86 on the Committee for Single Building Assessments that for Ms Duncan Glancy mentioned. And my thanks go to her for amendments 51 and 86, bringing a key point to the attention of this committee. Again, let me state that homeowners and residents must remain firmly at the heart of cladding remediation. We should and we will ensure that lived experience is considered as we develop, as we implement and improve our approach to cladding remediation. However, we note that it is important for residents affected by these issues that the cladding remediation programme is able to make as fast progress as possible. We believe that it is inevitable that placing an aspect of process on a strategy footing would act to delay rather than speed up the programme. So, therefore, I propose to engage the Letwith Ms Duncan Glancy to consider how best lived experience into our operational programme. And I think I wrote to you last night, which hopefully you have today, in terms of engaging with you on that particular process as we move towards stage three. You have my commitment to consider how best we ensure that we all are doing as best informed by lived experience of owners and occupiers, including those with disabilities. On this basis, I ask, therefore, that Pam Duncan Glancy not move amendments 51 and 86 and agrees to meet with me to consider how best we can embed lived experience into the remediation programme. I want to move on to amendment 83. This amendment would require that the SBA set out whether each risk identified during the assessment process is tolerable. This is not how tolerable risk will be assessed in the SBA. After identifying all the risks, the SBA will state which of these risks should be addressed and how, in order to bring the risk posed to human life as a whole down to a tolerable level. As such, there will not be a way to assess each risk as tolerable. Tolerable risk must be assessed in the round, taking into account the risks as a whole identified in relation to a building and how these risks may be mitigated. The way the amendment is expressed, therefore, would not allow an SBA to be conducted in the way it's required to be. In any event, besides, the standards and development are the best place to deal with the questions of how tolerable risk is identified. I therefore ask Mark Griffin not to move this amendment and ask members to reject it if it's moved. In terms of Amendment 42, convener, this amendment is a technical amendment to bring the definition of building height into line with the definition that we expect to see proposed for the Single Building Assessment Standard, which in turn draws on the definition contained within the PAS 9980 standards that are used elsewhere in the UK. An updated definition of building height will therefore support consistency between SBA assessments in Scotland and PAS 9980 and provide greater accuracy and clarity for all interested parties. And finally, on Amendment 85, a risk-based approach is consistently outlined the current scope of the programme as buildings over 11 metre height. Based on a risk-based assessment of capability to fight a fire, reflecting reach of ground, mounted water jets and use of specialist height appliances, the SBA is for buildings over 11 metres. The bill is reflective of this scope. Furthermore, if at a point in the future the ministers want to change that scope, then they would be subject to due consideration through appropriate regulations. We do not want to limit that flexibility by stating this is in the current bill. I reject this amendment and invite members to do the same.
Thank you. And before moving on to invite other members to speak, I'd just like to ask if all members could request interventions through the chair. Now I'd like to see if anyone else wants to speak to the amendments. No. Okay, Mark Griffin to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 46.
Thanks, Camilla. I appreciate the Minister and the Government's response to the amendments that I've tabled within this group. But like I said, they are probing amendments and I look forward to working with the Government on some of the detail as they go forward, because I think the single building assessment is such a crucial part of this legislation that there should be clarity for residents, for developers, as to what is contained within the single building assessment. As we go forward, I note that work continues within Government to conclude that by the end of May, and I look forward to discussions with Minister as to how we potentially incorporate some of that detail within the legislation ahead of Stage 3, and so seek permission to withdraw Amendment 46.
Mark Griffin seeks to withdraw Amendment 46. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Okay. Call Amendment 47 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. Call Amendment 48 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
call Amendment 12 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved formally, Convener.
Question is that Amendment 12 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 49 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 10. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. The question is that Section 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed. Call Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Yeah, if formally moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 13 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 2 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next grouping, which is communications and consultation. And I call Amendment 5 in the name of Graham Simpson, grouped with Amendments 55 and 2. Graham Simpson, to move Amendment 5 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks very much, Convener. So I move Amendment 5. Members will know that I was recently evacuated from the flat that I rented in Edinburgh. And you'll also know that everyone there that night got out okay, which is the most important thing. Now, the flats where I was living have cladding, and I know that the owners have been in discussions with the developers about that. So they very much fall into the scope of this bill. Now, one thing that struck me then was that there was no list of who actually lived there. And that would not tell you who was there at the time of the fire, but it would help, and it would especially help afterwards. And we had police going around asking for names and contact numbers of everyone who got out. They did that twice, and the contact details were never used. But they should have been, to provide updates to people. Communications were initially poor, but they've definitely improved. But no one appears to be in charge. We have a residents forum, which is very useful, but not everyone is necessarily aware of it or on it. Factors deal with owners as they should, but I've long thought that they should deal with anyone living in a development for which they are responsible. Tenants, as I was, should not have to rely on an owner who they may never have met to inform them of a building's fire safety status. Communication is key. Now, my Amendment 5 would see a register set up of owners and occupiers of buildings in the cladding assurance register. And that way, everyone would know if work is to be carried out. It would also mean that there's a central record of information should there be a fire. And that would be invaluable. Now, I would say the current system is haphazard, but there is no system. Wider issues with tenements are being looked at by the Scottish Law Commission and the Tenement Maintenance Working Group, which I convene. If members are interested, they can attend a joint meeting of these groups on the 8th of May from 6 o'clock in Committee Room 5. The other amendments in this group should also be supported. Pam Duncan-Glancy's Amendment 55, and yes, it does appear in this group, says ministers must consult with owners, occupiers and residents committees before arranging a single building assessment. But of course, you have to know who these people are first. So this amendment works well with my own. And Miles Briggs argues that these same people should be told the results of an assessment and be informed about any ongoing work. So there really is no reasonable argument to be made against any of these, but no doubt the Minister will have a go. Thank you.
Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 55 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And Amendment 55 is kind of in the similar vein to my previous amendments in the last group. So the last group was about a committee for all SBAs and an independent reviewer. Amendment 55 is specifically introducing mandatory provision that the ministers would consult occupiers and owners of a building before the single building assessment under legislation is undertaken on that particular building. And again, this is to add owner-occupier voice to the process. It's very much in response to a group of residents who I know the Minister is aware of, who felt that their voice wasn't fully taken account of within the development of the single building assessment. In some cases, things like Awake and Watch were put in place without really much consideration or much communication to the residents in advance. It was necessary at the time, of course, but again, residents felt particularly difficult about it and thought that they should have been a bit more involved in it. So that's what this amendment seeks, to guarantee that owners and occupiers will have a voice in the creation of single building assessments when it is relevant to their particular building. Thank you.
Thank you. And Miles Briggs to speak to Amendment 2 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And I think this goes to the heart of those who gave evidence to committee and those who are angry that we haven't seen any real progress in Scotland on this, but they have faced an information vacuum. I don't think that's fair, and we need to see that addressed. And that's why I've brought forward a duty to inform Amendment 2, which calls on the Scottish Government to inform occupiers of buildings the results of the single building assessment and an ongoing information which they will want to, as residents, be made aware of. Now, we don't have a timescale for when all works will take place, be it either the assessments, but then the works which may be needed. But I think it's important that those who are living in these buildings are put at the heart of that. And that's why I want to see this amendment passed and for government to really put that on the face of the bill, that those who are living in these buildings should know what's going on, should be given the information they're entitled to. And that hasn't happened to date. So I hope this is a working amendment which government will either accept today or take forward for stage 3, because we really need to see those affected put at the heart of the bill. And that's what I hope I've tried to achieve throughout the work on the committee, but also the debate when all this was highlighted as well at stage 1. I also think there's a lot of good additional information which Amendment 5 can also provide in the name of Graeme Simpson, again kind of making sure that residents who either own the property or who are renting that are actually properly collated is something which I think would add value, and as we take forward communications, that those who are potentially renting, not owner occupiers, are also given the same information. I don't see any difference in why they wouldn't be.
Okay, thank you. Do any other members wish to speak to these amendments? No. Minister.
Thanks, Convener. Convener, Amendment 5 in the name of Graeme Simpson seeks to establish a register of contact details for owners and occupiers to enable them to be notified of works to be carried out on their building, and in case of fire, so long as remediation works have not been carried out. Such a register will be maintained by either a factor, a residence committee, or by other such persons as Scottish ministers consider appropriate. In seeking to do so, Graeme Simpson's amendment is very likely reflective of common practice in multi-residential properties across Scotland. Factors, for example, will no doubt often maintain such lists as part of their routine business and best practice, and appreciate the comments that Mr Simpson has made, and I'll come on to that. However, I would have significant concerns regarding data protection. Yes.
The Minister says it's common practice to keep in communication with everyone living in a building, and he says that factors do that routinely. Factors do not do that routinely. Factors deal with owners, and owners may not live there. And that's the reality of this situation. And that's why my amendment, number 5, seeks to rectify that. But it certainly is not common practice. Yep. People who are renting are not generally communicated with.
I'll come on to that, and I appreciate, and I think I mentioned that, I appreciate the comments you said, because obviously you stayed in the area. I met with residents from your, obviously the area, the flats that you stayed in, and spoke to them directly about this issue and have a follow-up meeting with them on that particular point. As I said, I've got significant concerns regarding data protection if this practice was to be placed on a statutory footing, and I'll touch on that in a wee second. So the implications would need to be fully explored, and regrettably there isn't time available to us in the context off the bill. However, again, note that the maintenance of such lists is likely to be in common practice, and just as we've touched, and will no doubt be advantageous in the scenarios that Graeme Simpson refers to as his amendment. As part of the operational aspects of the Clad Remediation Programme, where the government is involved in remediation, it will encourage adequate communication with residents via factors or residents' associations. All that being said, in terms of amendment, therefore, before the committee, I urge committee members to reject it, but I'll come on into the other amendments and how we progress. He's moving on to Amendment 55 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy. I will state again to this committee and to those owners and residents of buildings within the scope of cladding remediation programme that our communications must improve where Scottish Government is involved in remediation of buildings. I previously updated this committee that we're working on an improved communications protocol, and we're ensuring that we're engaged fully with owners and residents ahead of ministers arranging for a single building assessment to be carried out will form part of this. As a result, I am of the opinion that the principle of Pam Duncan-Glynch's amendment is something which we can have some sympathy with. However, the amendment does not cover the situation where developers are in charge of the remediation of buildings, and it appears to me that the consultation with owners and occupiers should be conducted by the party in charge of remediation. I would therefore ask Pam Duncan-Glancy not to move this amendment, but to work with me instead to refine the details ahead of stage 3, and obviously mention the same thing to Graham Simpson. If the amendment is moved, I would ask committee members to reject that.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for that. And I do appreciate the willingness to talk more about this, and I appreciate the reaching out that you've done in your letter as well to offer this. The point that you've just made, though, or the point the Minister has just made, though, on developers leading the single building assessment, and so the position of the Minister's not necessarily being the people who do the consultation, that is part of the concern that I'm trying to address here, because residents are worried that with developers having sole control over the single building assessment as they see it, that they will not have the opportunity to input to that. So could the Minister clarify a little bit about how he envisages that conflict again being addressed if not supporting this amendment?
Yeah, I think that's why I'm coming back to, because obviously I'm aware of the situation in the building you're referring to. There are different situations in different parts of Scotland with different buildings. So it's trying to take that as a whole as part of the discussions we're having. So happy to discuss, and I'm aware of the specific point that you have on as we prepare to stage 3. But there are different situations in different buildings in the country, which we're hoping to pick up in all parts of, but happy to have that discussion, as we are having on that specific building that you mentioned. So I think I mentioned around, but obviously the amendment 55. We want to move on to government amendment, non-government amendment 2. And lastly, regarding the amendment in the name of Miles Briggs, the government again is sympathetic to the principle of this amendment, as it accords with our usual practices of open and transparent government. Sharing the results of the SBA will promote understanding of the process and the work that are to be carried out and enable homeowners and occupants to organise themselves accordingly. However, I have some technical concerns regarding the drafting of this provision and how it would operate in practice, such in cases where the remediation, again, is a developer-led, given the amendment places an obligation on ministers. I would therefore ask Miles Briggs not to move this amendment and work with the government to refine this again ahead of stage 3. If it's moved, I would ask the committee to reject this amendment. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Graham Simpson to wind up. Press or withdraw Amendment 5.
Thanks again, Convener. I don't have a lot to add. I was initially disappointed with the Minister's comments, but he did say, I'm sure I heard him say, that he was offering to work with me and others ahead of Stage 3. I think if the Minister is able to provide some clarity now as to the extent of that and whether we'll get to a point where he accepts my principle that all those living in a building should be communicated with, then I think I could accept what he's offering. If he wants to intervene, I'm happy to take the intervention if he wants to clarify that point.
Yeah, I suppose just on all things, I think that we've mentioned a bit of indication to work in regard to that, and obviously take the aspects that we kind of raised as a whole. So again, you know, we'll reach out to you in terms of having these further discussions. If there's a further clarity that you require before these, then obviously we'll kind of pick that up with you. And Ms. Duncan Glancy and Mr. Briggs, in terms of that, communication is really important, and we've seen that, just as you said, an incident you were involved in yourself, Mr. Simpson, so happy to engage with you before stage 3. But if there's any specifics, then obviously contact myself or colleagues in terms of that, so we can try and get through that. But I think we've shown the willingness to discuss the points that have been raised, which are, I think, are kind of all related all the way through that. But happy to clarify, to have a meeting to see how we can progress that as we move towards stage 3.
Okay. I thank the Minister for the intervention. I won't be looking for clarity, Convener. I'll be looking for an actual meaningful amendment at stage 3 that covers this point. So I'm prepared to give the Minister a chance here. I hope I don't regret it, but I will give him a chance. He likes his meetings, but this is, if we're to have a meeting, this is to be a meaningful meeting with action at the end of it, and an amendment or two for either myself or Miss Duncan Glancy or Mr. Briggs, whichever, or a combination. But we need action. It can't just be a meeting for meeting's sake. So on that basis, I will go with the minister on this occasion and not move Amendment 5.
Can you confirm if you withdraw Amendment 5?
I withdraw Amendment 5.
Graeme Simpson seeks to withdraw Amendment 5. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No objections. We're moving on to the next grouping, which is about liability for costs of assessment and remediation. I call Amendment 50 in the name of Miles Briggs, grouped with Amendments 54, 59 and 62. Miles Briggs to move Amendment 50 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And these amendments have been brought forward by myself, having been in communication with various homeowners across Scotland in the affected buildings, and specifically with regards to some of their concerns over future costs which they may face. And I wanted to therefore bring forward these amendments and see where government was in making sure that on the face of the bill, we clarify that owners and residents of buildings affected by cladding are not going to be held liable for those costs, but also the management of those costs going forward as well, because we know for many of the buildings which might be seen as having tolerable risk, there may then be additional costs on ongoing management, which at present would be part of a factoring bill, I would understand. And I think residents want to see clarification over what that will mean. I don't think any of us want to see a situation where this becomes a licence to print money, where homeowners are facing annual additional costs on their factoring bill for the inspection, for example, of any cladding which the government has decided under the single building assessment is seen as tolerable. So I wanted to do these probing amendments to see where ministers' thoughts were, and again, look towards where potentially at stage three there is an amendment to seek clarification for homeowners who, through no fault of their own, are living in these buildings with cladding, and any additional costs which government may place upon them and the management of their buildings. So the group of amendments 50, 54, 59 and 62 look to seek that clarification on the face of the bill.
Do you confirm that you move Amendment 50?
I move all four amendments, 50, 54, 59, 62.
You're just moving 50 at the moment.
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay. Do any other members wish to speak to the amendments in the group? Minister.
Thanks, Convener. Convener, as regards amendments 50, 54, 59, 62, would not be appropriate to amend this bill. And we propose there are a variety of circumstances in which cladding is managed, assessed and remediated. Amendment 50 in particular makes no distinction as to the characteristics of the building, so liability would be excluded for any owner, including owners of hotels, residential care homes, etc. In practice, this would prevent such owners being able to arrange for single building assessments and remediation if they wish. As regards to Amendment 54, this makes an amendment to a section dealing with ministerial powers, and so an exclusion of liability of costs for owners does not make sense in this context. In addition, those who instruct a single building assessment or work would, of course, under any ordinary contact arrangements, be liable to pay for it. There should be nothing to stop owners instructing their own SBA and remediation work if they want to, but this amendment would have that effect. As regards Amendment 59, its effect in the section relating to ministerial powers is unclear. However, in addition, an SBA contains a fire risk assessment, and therefore there may be issues identified that are the legal responsibility of owners, for example, keeping common passages clear. It would not be appropriate for this bill to exclude liability for this, and such a provision could have significant unforeseen circumstances regarding the safety of buildings. Amendment 52 is redundant as Section 7 relates to ministerial powers, and an exclusion of liability for owners does not make sense in this context. For all these reasons, I ask Miles Briggs to withdraw Amendment 50 and not to move the other amendments in the group. If the amendments are pressed, I urge members to reject them.
Miles Briggs to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 50.
As I said, these are a set of probing amendments, and I wondered if the Minister didn't comment on the rationale behind why I brought them forward, that specifically around future management of cladding. Now, the bill is very empty in terms of what post a single building assessment where a building is put in as tolerable risk or amber, and what that then means for future management of these buildings. So I'd be happy to work with the Minister to specifically look towards Stage 3 and amendment around that, because I think for homeowners, they want that clarification over who will be potentially paying for the costs of those. And as I said during Stage 1 debate, a lot of the work we've done as a committee and what's been brought forward has suggested actually a lot of future maintenance of buildings isn't included in this bill, and secondary factors around that. But we need to look towards that. That might be in the context of a specific factoring bill for the buildings, which will be identified and then rated in different ways, and then the ongoing maintenance of potential cladding, which is seen to be tolerable. So just wondered the Minister's thoughts on that, and whether or not there is scope for an additional amendment at Stage 3 around that.
In terms of Amendment 50 itself, I think we've kind of talked about this previously, in terms, and it kind of falls in within the scope, and I think you mentioned about a factoring bill, which I'm happy to pick up with you on that particular point, because again I think it's important about the scope of the bill and where that kind of fits in. But happy to pick up that particular point in terms of the other amendments, you know, as we go through the SB process. I talked about the bill process, but also past the bill, post-bill, and again give the commitment once the SB process moves to completion to have discussion about that. And specifically, Amendment 50 is something I'm happy to pick up in terms of the factor bill you kind of talked about as well. So happy to pick up that specific point in regarding to that specific factoring issue that you raised.
Okay, in that case, not moved.
Can I confirm that you withdraw Amendment 50?
Agreed.
Miles Briggs seeks to withdraw Amendment 50. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No objections. Call Amendment 51 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 46. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
On the basis of the Minister's commitments to discuss this issue at Stage 3, I'm minded not to move this amendment at this time, and so I will withdraw it, but I will be looking for significant commitments around committee to oversee the development of single building assessments and also the other amendments as well in this particular group, which I'll come to in a moment. But I will withdraw Amendment 51 at this point.
Call Amendment 52 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 46. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
Not moved, on the same basis as previously, that I'm happy to engage with the Minister between now and Stage 3 to see what further strengthening we can do to the bill to ensure there is independence and conflict of interest is removed from the bill, and that owners and occupiers have sufficient voice in the development of the single building assessment in general, but also specific to their own buildings. On that basis, I'm happy to withdraw Amendment 52.
Thank you. I call Amendment 53 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 46. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 54 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 50. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 55 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 5. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
Thank you, Convener. Not moved and withdrawn on the basis that there is a commitment from the Minister to discuss this between now and Stage 3.
The question is that Section 3 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 14 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Formally, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 15 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 4 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 5 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is, I call Amendment 16 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 16 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 56 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 57 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 17 in the name of Graham Simpson, Group... Actually, this is Right, we're moving on to a new grouping, racing through the last ones. Okay, so this is a new grouping, and that's around fire safety measures. And I call Amendment 17 in the name of Graham Simpson, group with Amendments 58 and 66. Graham Simpson to move Amendment 17 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks again, Convener. There's a bit of a pattern developing already. We'll see if that continues. I move Amendment 17. Of course, I once again share a group with Pam Duncan-Glancy, which is always a pleasure. I've got one amendment in this group, but given that the group is called Fire Safety Measures, it's pretty fundamental to the bill. Now, if you'll just allow me to remind the committee of its recommendation at paragraph 73 of its excellent report, and it says, quotes, "The committee notes the Scottish Government's expressed ambition for the bill is to address cladding issues and in doing so encourage speedier remediation. However, the committee heard in evidence concerns about wider fire safety issues, broader than cladding, and would welcome a response from the Scottish Government on how it plans to tackle these issues in the future. It would appear to the committee from the evidence it heard that the problems of obtaining building insurance and also resolving issues relating to lending and selling affected properties will persist if these wider fire safety issues are not resolved or managed." Very, very sensible stuff. And it's that issue of wider fire safety issues that my simple amendment seeks to address. Now, the Minister, in his response to the committee on this, said this: "Whilst additional risks related to building safety or fire prevention may become evident during the process of assessing and remediating unsafe cladding, it's important that we recognise that there are broader systems and legislation in place to manage these where they fall outside the scope of the cladding remediation programme." Now, I'm not exactly clear what he means by this, but in any case, my amendment to Section 6, which I now invite members to look at, merely adds the words, "including any associated fire safety risks." So that section would then read, "The Scottish Ministers may arrange for work to be carried out that is identified in a single building assessment report as being needed to eliminate or mitigate risks to human life that are directly or indirectly created or exacerbated by the building's external wall cladding system, including any associated fire safety risks." So it's within the scope of the bill, but in some ways alleviates the committee's justified concerns. You can't just look at one part of a building when assessing fire risk, but if a building has cladding, then to me other things become linked. Escape routes, alarm systems, sprinklers, lack of or otherwise, I could go on. But my amendment is narrowly worded, the convener having rejected an earlier effort, and I invite the committee to accept it. Now, Ms. Duncan-Glancy's substantive amendment in this group, number 66, calls for risks assessments to be done for any occupier with a disability. And she and I have discussed this. It throws up a number of issues, but in essence, she's right. I may respond to what she has to say once I've heard her, and indeed I'll come back on what the Minister has to say. I just hope he's as positive as he has been so far. I'll end it there. Thank you.
Can I confirm, Graham Simpson, that you move Amendment 17?
I did that right at the start.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to Amendment 58 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Amendment 50 in my name builds very much on what we've just heard from my colleague Graham Simpson, which is about the need to try and address other fire safety issues that may be identified in the process of the development of a single building assessment. The Minister will be aware that residents of buildings with flammable cladding on it have come to me and raised concerns about the fact that in the assessment that they've had made available by an independent fire engineer, other issues have been picked up, and their fear is that those other issues wouldn't be considered or wouldn't be part of an assessment as the bill is currently written. And so my amendment number 58 just says that the works that are any works identified by a single building assessment as having to be completed to mitigate the fire risk of dangerous cladding must be done in line with fire safety guidance, with the hope, therefore, that the broader safety and fire safety considerations may be taken into view. As Amendment 66 in my name is specifically about the issue of disabled people. During the Grenfell tragedy, as part of the inquiry into that, it was found that 41% of disabled people who lived there died in the fire. And I'm determined that we make sure that that never, ever happens again. And I think there are mechanisms within this legislation for us to do that. In the event that a fire did take place at a building with flammable cladding, there is presently a risk that there are no specific plans in place to ensure disabled people get to safety. And I want to try and do everything I can, as I'm sure others on the committee will do too, and the Minister, to mitigate the risk by ensuring that any works identified by a single building assessment under this legislation is followed up by having a specific assessment of the risk to disabled people in the building, including the terms of how they would be expected to escape. And I think Grenfell taught us many lessons, and we all have to work to make sure that it never happens again. But one of the starkest lessons, as I've said, is how fatal it can be when disabled people's particular issues are not necessarily provided for. And so Amendment 66 in my name seeks to give ministers the responsibility to ensure that in a specific risk assessment where it is undertaken, that disabled people are considered within that particular building so that they know in the event of a fire or evacuation, there is specific support and a plan to help them get out. It also, the amendment does then seek to revert back to ordinary standard procedures once the building has been remediated so that it's not to bring it out with scope of the piece of legislation. But I think, given what we've learned from Grenfell, I think this amendment is particularly important and I'd encourage members and the Minister to give it serious consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. Do any other members wish to speak to these amendments? No. Minister.
Thanks, Convener. I'll speak first to Amendment 17 in this group, which seeks to amend Section 6 of the Bill. Section 6 of the Bill refers to the building's external cladding system as the basis for Scottish Ministers to arrange for work identified in a single building assessment where such work is needed to eliminate or mitigate risks to human life. Amendment 17 would add any associated fire risk to that of the cladding system. As such, it would broaden out the scope of the cladding remediation programme. I recognise the positive intent of this amendment, but on my balance, my position is to retain a focus on the cladding system. The narrow focus of the bill is imperative to ensure that multi-residential buildings that we have identified as part of the most risk are causing harm due to unsafe cladding and remediated as swiftly as possible. For good reason, wider fire safety is out with the scope of the cladding remediation programme and cannot be addressed on this bill. On this basis, I urge Grimsons not to press Amendment 17 or for the committee to reject as is pressed. However, I do acknowledge the points that he's raised, and I'm happy to write to the member on the wider fire safety aspect that you mentioned in that, and happy to meet with you on that regard. Moving on to Amendment 58, I'll now come back on Amendment 58, which seeks to amend Section 6 by requiring any works carried out under the section to adhere to the latest fire safety guidance. Of course, this should always be the case, but I have concerns about the drafting of this amendment. There is a lack of clarity as to whose guidance is to be followed. That question is left open, and this therefore prompts additional question and uncertainty as to what should be considered the latest fire safety guidance. Convener, I consider the position on fire safety guidance to be clearly set out with this bill, and the single building assessment process will be the place for a qualified person to assess fire risk. This is not something that should be covered via an amendment to this bill, and I therefore ask the member not to move this amendment if it's moved, and would ask committee to reject it. Lastly, coming on to Amendment 66 in the name of Pan Duncan Glancy, raises an important point. How do we ensure the safety of building occupants with a disability where that building is an identified risk following a single building assessment? While having great sympathy with the intent of this amendment, I am concerned that the amendment presented may be unworkable in terms of the sensitive personal data that would require ministers to collect and store. This needs to be carefully considered, not only here today, but amongst a full range of partners who can contribute to developing and operationalising an appropriate solution. This is the reason why I will not be able to support it today. However, I'd like to discuss this further with Pam Duncan Glancy and very much hope the member will work with me on that or in a bit of specific points that she mentioned. So in conclusion, Convener, I would ask him since to withdraw Amendment 17 and said I would contact him in writing about the wider fire safety issues. Pam Duncan Glancy not to move Amendments 58 and 66
If the amendments are pressed, I will ask committee members to vote against them. Thanks, Convener.
Graeme Simpson to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 17.
Yeah, thanks again, Convener. So I've listened with interest, as I always do, to Pam Duncan-Glancy. I think she raises very, very important issues, because you can imagine, committee members can imagine, if there's a disabled people in a disabled person in a block of flats, unless they're on the ground floor, and there's a fire, they could struggle to get out of a burning building when, you know, lifts are obviously will be out of action. How do they get out? You just dread to think it would be an awful situation. So I think Pam Duncan-Glancy raises a really important issue. The minister talks about sensitive personal data. That is a fair point to make, but I would have thought that if there was a system in place whereby disabled people could declare themselves disabled, then some kind of register or list could be kept. So you'd at least know there was a disabled person in flat 1, 2, 3, or 4, wherever it was, and plans could be put in place in the awful event of a fire breaking out. And I think that's what Pam Duncan-Glancy is actually getting at here. Disappointed the minister has only offered to write to me. I do enjoy reading his letters, but I think I would have been looking for something a bit stronger than just writing to me. I'm happy to receive his correspondence, but it sounds like we're not going to agree on this issue, probably never. So I'll look forward to the letter, but I think I'll press this amendment on the basis he's not offered to work with me for stage three. So I'll press this one. We may as well give the committee a vote.
The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Nope.
We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour? And those against? Got it. And any abstentions? The result of the division on the amendment is those in favour 3, those against 4, and there were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. Call Amendment 18 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 18 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed. I call Amendment 58 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy. Already debated with Amendment 17. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
Thank you, Convener. And on the basis of what we've just seen, I think I will withdraw this amendment at this moment in time. And undertake to work with the Minister going forward on it.
Can I just confirm that you're not moving this amendment?
58. I'm not moving.
Not moving. Thank you. Call Amendment 59 in the name of Miles Briggs. Already debated with Amendment 50. Miles Briggs to move or not move? I call Amendment 19 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 20 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 6 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 60 in the name of Mark Griffin. Already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 61 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 21 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 21 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 22 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Yeah, moved.
The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 62 in the name of Miles Briggs. Already debated with Amendment 50. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 7 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're going to move on to the next grouping, which is around the power to evacuate. And I call Amendment 63 in the name of Miles Briggs, grouped with Amendments 23, 24 and 65. Miles Briggs to move Amendment 63 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and move Amendment 63 and 65 in my name. The bill does give ministers substantial powers, and so specifically my two amendments in this group look towards ministers acting reasonably. I think in terms of in ministers exercising their powers, we need to look towards how that will be taken forward and any potential grounds for legal challenge which overreach might bring forward. So this was really looking towards putting in on the face of the bill where ministers will act reasonably in exercising their powers under Section 8.
Ministers, speak to Amendment 23 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. I'll speak to Amendments 23 and 24 in this group. Convener, occupants may be required to evacuate from premises where there is a substantial risk to life due to the external mold system of a building. However, the risk may not be shared equally by all occupants who are required to remove from that building, as often as the most significant risk will be to those higher up a building. It is therefore important that evacuation power is available in relation to premises whose occupation would create a substantial risk to others, even in the lives of the occupants of those premises who are not themselves at risk. Taking as an example where the continuing occupation and use of ground floor commercial premises is putting the lives of others within the building at risk, we must be able to act decisively and instruct removal from the ground floor premises in order to prevent risk to those higher up in the building. Government Amendments 23 and 24 seek to address this and other similar situations, and I ask members to support them. In terms of Amendments 63 and 65, I'll now turn to those in the name of Miles Briggs. Convener, as a matter of public law, it is already very clearly the case that Scottish ministers must act reasonably and proportionately in exercising any of their powers. Any exercise of the power to evacuate will, of course, have to be based on robust evidence. There is no alternative or mitigation. This will be specific to each unique development and set of circumstances. Adding the word reasonable does not enhance the bill or change the law in any way and is therefore entirely unnecessary. I therefore ask that Miles Briggs does not press Amendment 63 and not move 65. If these amendments are pressed, I invite members to reject them.
Do any other members wish to speak to amendments in this group? Miles Briggs to wind up. Press or withdraw Amendment 63?
I'll withdraw 63 and 65.
It's just 63, yeah. Okay. Miles Briggs seeks to withdraw Amendment 63. Do any members object to the amendment being withdrawn? No objections. Call Amendment 23 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 63. Minister to move formally.
Yeah, move.
The question is that Amendment 23 be agreed. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 24 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 63. Minister to move formally.
Yeah, moved.
The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 64 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 25 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to formally move. The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 65 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 63. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
Okay, we're going to move on to the next groupings, which is around notices, and I call Amendment 26 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 33 and 34. Minister to move Amendment 26 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thanks, Convener. I move Amendment 26. Section 8 of the Bill refers to the ministerial power
to evacuate, and Section 16 refers to giving notice where the recipient's address is unknown. In both cases, there is an obligation to display a notice on or near the premises. Amendments 26 and 34 simply clarify that such notices must be displayed conspicuously. This in line with similar provisions made in legislation elsewhere. Amendment 33 further amends Section 16 to the effect that a notice which is displayed is taken to be received 48 hours after it is put up. It is important to be clear when the notice period starts and finishes, and the absence of owner consent, it is only after the required period of notice that single building assessment and mediation work can then begin. It is thought to be reasonable to deem a notice to be received 48 hours after it is displayed. Thanks, Convener.
Do any other members wish to speak to the amendment? Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add.
The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 8 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Schedule 1 and Section 9 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 2 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 5. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
In light of what the Minister has said, around some technical issues he has with my amendment, but willing to discuss and bring back at stage three, then not moved.
Okay. We're going to move on to the next grouping, which is around the appeal against arranged remediation work, and I call Amendment 7 in the name of Graham Simpson in a group on its own. Graham Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 7.
Thanks again, Convener. Move Amendment 7. This amendment is the only one in the group, deals with Section 10 of the Bill, which allows for appeals to a sheriff against arranged remediation work. And the view of property managers who've spoken to me is that a sheriff, being a layman in technical terms, even acting on the advice of a professional witness, is unqualified to interpret and then singularly determine or make an order on often vastly complicated as-built technical challenges. And I agree with that assessment, so my amendment says that sheriffs should nominate a panel of experts and take their views into account when dealing with these appeals. And again, I invite the committee to support this common sense, another common sense amendment, Minister.
Do any other members wish to speak to this amendment? Minister.
Thanks, Convener. Amendment 7 in the name of Graham Simpson seeks to require that a sheriff appoint a panel of technical experts with knowledge and experience of remediation work and take into account their views when making a decision on an appeal. I recognise the positive intent of Graham Simpson's amendment here, as there may often be technical matters and it may be that expert advice would assist the court. However, I would point out that the appeals under Section 10 would carry a great degree of urgency, as it would be brought in cases where a single building assessment produced by appropriately qualified professionals has identified a need to act promptly to eliminate or mitigate risks to human life. A requirement to appoint a panel of experts would almost invariably add to the time it takes for a court to consider an appeal in what may be life-critical matters. This is not to say there's not a role for technical experts in some cases, and parties may instruct their own expert witnesses. However, it's not proportionate to require a sheriff to nominate a panel in every case, and I would have concerns about the impact of this amendment on judicial independence and to deal with cases as the court sees fit. The government's informal engagement with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service ahead of Stage 2 suggests that they would at least share some of these concerns. It is also unclear how this would work in practice, and there are questions about cost, size, composition of the panel. Is the membership agreeable to both parties, for example, as well as the impact on court rules? For these reasons, I ask that Graham Simpson not press Amendment 7, but if the amendment is pressed, then I ask the committee to reject it.
Graham Simpson, to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 7.
Thanks again, Convener. I always think it's useful at Stage 2 that people actually listen to the arguments presented and be prepared to change their minds, even if you've got a voting intention right in front of you, even if you are moving an amendment. So I've listened to the Minister's arguments and he has persuaded me. So I will not be moving this amendment.
Great.
That's what we need. We need more of it, Minister.
Graham Simpson seeks to withdraw Amendment 7. Do any members object to the amendment being withdrawn? The question is that Section 10 be agreed. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 27 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 27 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 28 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 29 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 29 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 11 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Moving on to another grouping around warrant authorising use of force of effect to effect entry. And I call Amendment 30 in the name of a minister in a group on its own. Minister, to move and speak to Amendment 30.
Thanks, Convener. I move Amendment 30. Section 12.6c currently includes a Justice of the Peace as a judicial office holder to whom an application for a warrant authorising the use of reasonable force entry may be made, but Amendment 30 deletes this reference. Given the urgency attached to such warrant applications, we want to make sure that the process runs as smoothly and as quickly as possible. It's understood that in practice such applications are likely to be more speedily dealt with through an application to a sheriff or summary sheriff, and the bill should therefore direct applicants accordingly. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. Do any other members wish to speak to this amendment? Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 12 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 31 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 13 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 14 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 15 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 33 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 34 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 16 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 17 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 66 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, already debated with Amendment 17. Pam Duncan Glancy, to move or not move?
Thank you, Convener. On the basis of the undertaking of the Minister to speak with me between now and Stage 3, to and I seek assurances and have sought assurances that we will work together to do something on the bill that will protect disabled people in the case of flammable cladding being found on the building. On that basis, I withdraw Amendment 66 at this point.
Can I confirm, Pam Duncan-Glancy, that you are not moving Amendment 66?
Yep, I am not moving Amendment 66.
Thank you. The question is that Sections 18 and 19 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Now we're moving on to another grouping around the Responsible Developer Scheme. And I call Amendment 67 in the name of Miles Briggs, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Miles Briggs, to move Amendment 67 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and move Amendment 67. And hopefully members will follow my train of thought throughout this set of amendments, quite a lot of them. But I think these are important to seek I hope, in terms of these probing amendments, to seek some clarification from government, because I think it's important in terms of what will be that responsible developer scheme, how it will be operational. And there's a number of areas I don't think the bill currently presents that. So in relation to Amendment 67, this line empowers the Scottish Government to create several responsible developer schemes, and interested to see why several would be needed, and in terms of any resources which are there therefore brought forward, how that would be administrated within several schemes. Amendment 68 also looks towards proportionate contributions from both developers, but also potential supply chain as well, contributions which could be realised. There's also, in relation to Amendment 71, 72, issues with regards to paying fees into the scheme. I don't think there's clarification over how much that will be, and as we move to stage three, how that will be operational as well. Concerns have also been expressed over the opportunity for right of appeal as well. So I think it's important that we look towards anyone who would be excluded from this scheme and what impact that could have, to also be clear within the bill. So my amendment 78 looks towards sufficient detail around rights of appeal to be created through regulations as well. Amendment 79, it's important, I think all of us have accepted the need to create the right environment for developers to be able to fund and fix cladding and remediation works which might take place. So this is a probing amendment which would remove powers to create a prohibited development list, because I think there's concern over what that would mean in effectively blacklisting companies in Scotland. For some SMEs, that could be hugely damaging. It would put them out of business. My Amendment 3 as well is something which I'm really keen to see where government is on in the rest of the UK and England. SMEs with an annual turnover of £10 million have been excluded from the scheme. We know the low levels of completions we've seen recently and what impact that can have on rural and island communities where most schemes, most housing is being developed by SMEs. So wondered what impact assessments had been also likely to taken place on how this bill will impact on those SMEs, and I take on board there is a limited number who are exposed to the buildings which have been brought forward in the first phase of this. But these are a set of probing amendments which I hope are useful for us to look at unintended consequences on developers, and happy to work with ministers ahead of stage three to iron out some of the detail of this. But I think clarification specifically around the scheme would be useful, and any unintended consequences which might see developers blacklisted.
Ministers, speak to Amendment 35 and all other amendments in the group.
Thanks for that. And I'll move on to Amendments 35 and 36. And I appreciate the comments that Miles Briggs has mentioned, and he's made it appropriate to myself. I have had a number of meetings with Homes for Scotland, particularly in about the SME concerns that are raised, and these will obviously be part of the SBA process as it continues, then moving on to the Responsible Developer Scheme, just as a general kind of context. But I want to talk firstly on Amendments 35 and 36. Amendment 35 requires Scottish Ministers to consult before making regulations establishing a Responsible Developer Scheme, primarily with those concerned with construction or development of buildings, but this will also include any persons that the Scottish Ministers include appropriate. This amendment responds to concerns raised during the Stage 1 process in relation to the lack of detail and lack of consultation regarding the Responsible Developer Scheme. And I trust this will be welcomed by the committee. Requiring consultation on the details of the Responsible Developer Scheme before developing secondary legislation signals their intention to work collaboratively and undertake a full consultation with developers, including SMEs and other industry parties. Developers have an important part to play in Scotland's economy by providing safe and high-quality homes, and we want to work with them to ensure a proportionate and collaborative approach to delivery of the cladding remediation programme. Amendment 36 clarifies the definition of a developer in Section 21.6. This is also part of the Government's response to concerns raised during the Stage 1 process regarding some of the definitions in the bill. I now want to move on to Amendment 67, and I'll also touch on the remaining amendments in the group in the name of Miles Briggs. And covering these amendments, convener, I would ask committee members to keep in mind the Scottish Government's clear policy objective that developers must play their part in making buildings safe. The Scottish Government would expect developers to similarly commit to identifying, assessing and remediating buildings in Scotland, as they have done in Wales and England. In terms of the amendment itself, I shall start with Amendment 67, which covers Section 20 of the bill, and in doing so appears to have the aim of removing the ability of Scottish Ministers to set up more than one scheme. My position is that it's important that Ministers have the necessary ability to respond to the needs of homeowners, developers and other stakeholders. Following consultation, we will be in a better position to determine precisely what is required, and therefore maintaining the ability to form more than one scheme has been placed in the bill. This will potentially enable us to design schemes for different sizes or types of developers with accuracy and sensitivity to their needs. I would therefore ask the member not to press Amendment 67. I want to move on to Amendment 68. This seeks to amend Section 20 by changing the purpose of a scheme from requiring a person in industry to address or contribute to the costs of addressing issues covered by the bill and the cladding mitigation programme to instead state they should make a reasonable and proportionate contribution. I'm concerned that this apparently slight change in wording could have the effect of diluting the policy aim that I've stated earlier, which is that developers must play their part in making buildings safe. That is, the stated aim of the Responsible Developer Scheme is for developers to address and contribute to buildings that they have developed. The provision, as it stands, allows flexibility in subsequent regulations as to how developers will be involved in the mediation. The consultation that precedes the making of regulations will allow for this issue to be explored in more detail, and I would not wish to reduce the mandate of that consultation by reducing flexibility at this point. I ask the member, therefore, not to move this amendment. Moving on to Amendment 71, this seeks to remove the option that schemes set up by subsequent regulations may require members or persons seeking to become members to pay fees. Now, although I can understand this to be something we would like to see excluded from any future scheme, it is something that is important. It remains an option for Scottish ministers, as it requires consideration as to the impact on the public purse of the cladding mitigation programme and allows ministers to require, for example, admin fees to be paid as part of that scheme. In that context, I again refer members to the policy objective I stated some moments ago. Clearly, this is something that will form part of the Government's consultation, and I acknowledge that there will be some strong views regarding any such fee. However, my position is that it is important to separate out that question from the question of whether Scottish ministers should have the option of requiring fees of scheme members, and therefore I cannot support this amendment, and I would urge Miles Briggs to withdraw it or for committee members to reject it, if pressed. Moving on to Amendment 75, this relates to conditions of membership and inserts the words reasonable and proportionate into the existing provision that requires scheme members to make financial contributions in respect of single building assessments and the carrying out of work identified in such assessments. I am concerned that this change could potentially limit the scope of how scheme members will contribute to the scheme, and I consider it unnecessary at that point. Again, I'd like to point out the consultation process to flesh this out, and I'm concerned that adding this wording to primary legislation will limit what is possible in the regulations. I want to move on to Amendments 76, 77 and 78, which concern the right of appeal and change potential for regulations to provide for a right of appeal to a court or tribunal to a requirement that they should, within Amendment 78, seeking to add in some procedural details that should be covered in the regulations. Again, this seems a reasonable proposition, but I would want to fully consider the impact this amendment might have on the Scottish courts and tribunal service and what other options would be available. Again, I consider that this is best explored via the consultation process. On Amendment 3, this would insert a requirement to Section 21 on eligibility of membership, that membership of a responsible developer scheme would be restricted to developers with a turnover of above £10 million. By the way of background, convener, the Scottish Government is currently engaged in detailed discussion with a wide range of developers, including smaller developers, on the detail of the Scottish Safer Buildings Developer Remediation Contract. The intention is that there will be a close alignment between this contract and the schemes. One of the key themes in these discussions is a developer's ability to pay, and we have established a task and finish group focused on ability to pay, which is engaging closely with developers and Homes for Scotland, as I mentioned, on financial thresholds, the contribution of smaller developers and arrangement for firms that may find themselves in financial distress. Amendment 3 would again reduce the flexibility of the regulations that would create the scheme. We do not wish to put such a figure on the face of the bill, as we may require to amend it in order to ensure the fairest settlement for all parties. Again, reducing the flexibility of the scheme prior to consultation is undesirable. This is the same approach taken in by the UK Building Safety Act 2022, which left such details to regulations that formed the UK Government's Responsible Actors Scheme. I want to move on to Amendment 72. This seeks to amend Section 21 by adding in that eligibility for the scheme will be dependent on a person having connection to a building that is described by the regulations as posing a risk to human life created or exacerbated by problem cladding. However, since Section 21(6) of the bill already defines problematic cladding as cladding that is directly or indirectly the cladding system creates or exacerbates a risk to human life, the amendment would have no effect on the bill other than to confuse matters. As such, and in the interest of simplicity, I ask members to reject this amendment if it's moved. And finally, in the group convener, I shall speak to Amendment 79. I very much welcome the approach taken by the majority of developers concerned and taking responsibility for their part on the programme. Many are keen to go on with the job, and indeed aspects of this bill are expressly to help them do so. At the same time, it is important any responsible developer scheme does carry with it an accountability mechanism so that those who are responsible are not disadvantaged compared with those who are not. Considerable development has gone into these sections, which take a similar approach again to those enacted by the Westminster Government. Amendment 79 would remove Section 24, which establishes that the responsible developer scheme may contain, in effect, sanctions against any person included on a prohibited developer's list. Section 24 is crucial to the operational integrity and thus deliverability of the scheme. Acknowledging, again, that this will be subject to consultation, my position is that Section 24 must remain in the bill in order for the Government can introduce an element of sanction to the scheme. Convener, in conclusion, on the whole, I recognise Miles Briggs' desire and indeed the desire of other members for more detail of the scheme. But in view of the Government's stated intention to consult, I ask Miles Briggs not to press Amendment 67 and not to move 68, 71, 3, 72, 75, 76, 77, 78 and 79. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Do any other members wish to speak to amendments in this group? Miles Briggs to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 67.
Thank you, Convener. I think in the Minister's comments, he did touch upon Amendments 76 and 77, and I think 78, and some of the concerns around where right of appeal currently is not strong within the bill. I don't know if that, therefore, is something the Minister is mindful to be able to discuss ahead of Stage 3. I think for those SMEs, there is concern over what will effectively become a blacklisting exercise by Scottish ministers. Now, we have had previous concerns over how that has practices like that taking place in Scotland, and I am concerned over what that potentially looks like, especially when SMEs will be included in all of this legislation, and wanted to seek more detail over that. I think as well in terms of profit margins, there hasn't been clarity, I think, from Scottish Government over what has already been taken into account as a UK-wide profit margin and where the Scottish legislation would take that UK-wide profit margin again rather than profits only raised or secured here in Scotland. So I think these are areas Scottish Government need to, at Stage 3, provide that clarification, because none of us want to see developers simply going out of business and then not realising the resources which will be needed, specifically around orphan buildings as well. That driving the number of orphan buildings up is not in interest of anyone. So just wondered where the Scottish Government will, at Stage 3, provide more details around that. And happy to work with the Minister on workable amendments, specifically around 76, 77 and 78.
Yeah. Happy to discuss Miles Briggs about the specific concerns he raised. I said that there's a consultation process which is already in place, and there are discussions with colleagues in terms of Homes for Scotland and SME builders and about some of the specific points that he mentioned. But happy to discuss with the points that you've raised, Mr Briggs, on that before Stage 3.
Thank you. Miles Briggs to press or withdraw Amendment 67.
Withdraw.
Miles Briggs wishes to withdraw Amendment 67. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No objections. Call Amendment 68 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 69 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 70 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 71 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 35 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 67. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 35 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 20 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 3 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 72 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Moved.
I call Amendment 36 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 67. Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 73 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 74 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
The question is that Section 21 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 37 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 38 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 75 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. And Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 39 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 40 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 76 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 22 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 77 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Call Amendment 78 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 23 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 79 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 67. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
So I have to just go here. The question is that Section 24 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're now going to move on to a grouping around the reinsurance scheme. And I call Amendment 8 in the name of Graeme Simpson in a group on its own. Graeme Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 8.
Thanks once again, convener. I can't help reflecting on what a well-behaved committee this is. Very quiet. I think it's the only committee meeting I've attended where Mr. Beattie has not said a word, but we'll see if that continues. One amendment in this group. It's about a reinsurance scheme. Again, it flows from my discussions with property managers. Where there's been an evacuation, the co-owners could invalidate the terms of their building's insurance, whether communal or individual policies, as there will be an unoccupancy clause requiring the premises to be lived in or inspected at regular intervals. And insurers would not need any excuse to apply this clause, and having an evacuated building would make renewal of an insurance policy, in particular communal policy, extremely challenging, if not impossible. Insurance renewal concerns are indeed a common theme of concerns arising from the unintended consequences of all sections of the bill where co-owners are dispossessed of control of their premises. And as I said earlier, I've got some experience of this and have seen the anguish caused. Now, in the event that the unintended consequence of any part result in the withdrawal of insurers from a property, then it would seem reasonable for the state to give a guarantee of insurance via an underwritten scheme. Now, I'm told there was a roundtable meeting attended by the minister and others just before Christmas, in which this was raised, At that meeting, the Minister referred to talks with his counterparts in other parts of the UK over such a scheme. Now, the bill makes no mention of insurance. That's remiss, in my view. The committee's report does mention insurance a number of times, though not this particular issue. Now, Convener, I've had some very useful feedback on this amendment from the Association of British Insurers. In the interest of time, I'm not going to read out everything they sent to me, but I'll just read out a couple of sections. One says insurers will need to understand the circumstances of any evacuations or extended periods when properties are unoccupied, and these may run across renewal periods for policies we're not aware of major concerns in this area, and cover should still be available in the market subject to conditions in policies to recognise properties are not occupied. And they go on to say, we don't understand how a reinsurance scheme as proposed by me would address concerns about cover being invalidated by properties not being occupied for an extended period of time, as a reinsurance scheme would relate to the affordability of a policy rather than the terms of cover. So therefore, they say they don't support the proposal for Scottish ministers to provide a reinsurance scheme. I thought it was useful for the committee to hear that balance to my proposal. So we've heard from the industry, they're not in support of it, but they have offered to work with me on a separate amendment to consider the issue of unoccupied properties at stage three. So once again, Convener, I'm going to be extremely reasonable and listen to the arguments put by the Minister. I'll see what he has to say, if he wants to work with me and indeed the insurers ahead of stage three. That would be very positive, but I'll hear what he's got to say.
Do any other members wish to speak to this amendment? No. Minister.
This amendment from Graham Simpson would require Scottish ministers to create a reinsurance scheme via regulations to promote affordability and availability of insurance for an owner or occupier with a premise with unsafe cladding. There's dubiety in terms of both the meaning and effect of the provision. It's not evident what scheme would be created and what it would seek to achieve, and it's not clear to me who the scheme would be aimed at or how. As such, I'm unable to make any assessment on the likely costs of affordability of any such scheme. We do not support this amendment based on the unclear drafting, and I take in consideration what Mr Simpson said in terms of working with insurers. Aim and preferred outcome of such a scheme legislation should be drafted clearly and precisely. The lack of clarity also becomes relevant when considering the potential costs of such a scheme, as these cannot be quantified, and that itself makes the amendment difficult to support. Members, we wish to note that we've engaged with the Association of British Insurers, who have indicated they would not support this amendment. Instead, more pragmatic measures are preferable to ABI. We'll be working with them and, of course, other stakeholders to define the detail that we'd like to see in the cladding assurance register. And he touched on the point about the occupation unoccupied buildings at this stage. So accordingly, I would urge the member to withdraw this amendment and, in terms of his discussions with ABI. You know, if he wants to keep us up to date with that, then obviously there might be an opportunity to see what would possibly come through if he wants to move an amendment at stage three. But as I said, we have engaged with ABI and had similar feedback in terms of what you've said yourself. So.
To wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 8.
Convener, I'm going to withdraw on the basis of the comments from ABI, who would be very keen to work with ahead of stage three, and indeed I'm keen to work with the Minister if he's up for that, but if he's not, I will keep in contact with him with regards to my discussions with ABI. So I'll withdraw on that basis.
Graham Simpson seeks to withdraw Amendment 8. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Okay. We're going to move on to the next grouping, which is amendments around reviews and reports. And I call Amendment 1 in the name of Miles Briggs, grouped with Amendments 4, 6, 80 and 9. Miles Briggs to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group.
I move Amendment 1. There's three key amendments within this set of reviews. The first being in relation to other buildings. And during our Stage 1 report, I raised this with many people who gave evidence, specifically around buildings which are currently not going to be part of a single building assessment, but where people are sleeping, specifically around hotels, care homes, and student accommodation as well. And although these have been included in other schemes and in other potential reviews, there isn't a timescale for what that will look like in Scotland. Now, I know that work is already ongoing with regards to some student accommodation, but wanted to see where ministers will look towards these buildings also being reviewed, and those over 11 metres specifically being captured going forward. So I think it is important that we do look towards that and how that is managed by ministers under the scheme going forward. My Amendment 4 also looks towards undertaking a review of how the Act will impact on the construction industry. In my previous set of amendments, I did express concern over the SME sector. We know that completions, as I said earlier, are at an all-time low, and this will potentially have impacts on our construction industry and home building industry, and what that will mean for the housing crisis and delivering homes for people across Scotland is something ministers have to be mindful of. So this Amendment 4 would call on ministers to undertake a review of the Act and how it is impacting on the construction industry. And finally, my Amendment 80 specifically asks ministers also to undertake an annual review around that as well, to undertake a review of the Act as it stands. I'm suggesting an annual review, happy to discuss that with ministers, but there's a lot in this Act, which the only thing which isn't in this Act is how long it will take for us to be able to say that we have addressed all cladding concerns in Scotland. That could be a decade away, and how the Act is effective or ineffective going forward in helping homeowners to make sure that their house is properly reported on and then potentially made safe through remediation or management, as may be the case for those which are seen as being of a tolerable standard, I think it's really important, and where we just seem to be at the start of this journey. So my Amendment 80 provides for that review of the Act and its actions. And so I move Amendment 1 in my name.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson to speak to Amendment 6 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think this may be the last time I speak in this particular meeting. Members will be relieved to hear. We're almost there. So the amendments in this group for myself and Miles Briggs would introduce the requirement to, in the case of my own amendment, produce an annual report of single building assessments. Amendment 6 simply lists the things that the report should include. For me, this is about transparency. We need to have this information. Now, the government may say it's all too difficult, but as we've heard throughout this session, information, communication is key. So I do think this is important. I think the issue that Mr. Briggs raises is also important. As I close, Convener, can I thank you for the way you've convened this meeting. We've rattled through it. So well done. Well done, everyone.
Thank you. Do any other members wish to speak to these amendments? Minister.
Thanks, Convener. There are a number of amendments in this group, and I'll first of all speak to Amendment 1 from Miles Briggs, which seeks that ministers agree to undertake a review of the meaning of single building assessment 12 months after royal assent. This is with a particular focus on extending single building assessments and the provisions of this bill to buildings that contain at least one room used as overnight accommodation or short-term dwelling. From the members' previous contributions, I believe that this, with a view to bringing, for example, hotels and care homes into scope, have been clear from the outset of the programme and imperatively which this bill aims to address, is notably around about consent, an issue that is not applicable to non-residential buildings like hotels and care homes. These buildings have a single owner. We must remember that the main driver for the bill is the need to address barriers and challenges to assessing and remediating cladding within multi-residential domestic buildings. Building safety is the responsibility of the building owner. Where there are clear owners and duty holders of non-domestic buildings such as hotels, we would rightly expect them to understand and assess any risks of their cladding, where necessary to take action to remediate unsafe cladding. It's not to downplay the importance of safety in other buildings, far from it, but to recognise the prime purpose of the bill and the powers that are contained within it as to address challenges that have been encountered in multi-residential premises. Yeah, of course.
I take what he said so far in relation to, you know, a care home or hospital setting. I think for student accommodation, increasingly looking at how student accommodation has been built, it's been built for multiple occupancy, maybe of 4 to 8 students, in what would be otherwise looking at any development, a mixed development and mixed tenancy. So I'm concerned that they haven't been included to date, and just wondered what work government had undertaken around that student accommodation in Scotland to look at the numbers, which potentially are over 11 metres and fall within scope of the bill.
Yeah, happy to the member on that, what's been undertaken so far, and happy to discuss that. I know we've discussed that in the previously, Mr Biggs, not just in terms of student accommodation, but other groups in terms of that, so happy to write to you on that specific point. Just coming back to speaking to the amendments, of course the committee has heard much of the need to increase the pace of progress in cladding remediation, and I'm committed to delivering that. Any dilution of its focus will limit progress and impact on these residents and owners already affected by the ongoing risks from potentially unsafe cladding, in terms of just what I mentioned about the offer to write to Mr Briggs. I therefore ask Mr Briggs to withdraw this amendment, and I urge members, if pressed, to reject it, but happy to pick up the issues that he's raised in terms of that. I want to move on to amendments 4, 6, 9 and 80 from Miles Briggs and Graeme Simpson regarding annual reporting. Let me first of all say I'm of course supportive of the principles of open and transparent government, and in fact I've already given a commitment to the committee to move to regular reporting on the progress of the cladding remediation programme. These amendments all go further and would require ministers to prepare an annual report on the progress and impact of this legislation, and in turn the cladding remediation programme itself. Amendments 4 and 80 focus specifically on the impact on industry, 4 on the construction industry, and on 80 on industries affected by the Act and economic analysis of the programme. Whilst I'm supportive of this in principle and actively working to ensure that a developer's ability to pay is factored into the separate development work we are undertaking on the Scottish Safer Buildings Development Remediation Contract, I cannot support Amendment 4 requirements that an annual report is produced that focuses solely on the impact of the construction industry. Similarly, I cannot support Amendment 80, which would require consultation and economic analysis on you on an annual basis. But this would, of course, be burdensome and require specialist input in terms of economic analysis at the cost to government. We are already working with developers to consider their ability to pay as part of the development of the Scottish Safer Buildings Developer Remediation Contract, and the committee to consult on any responsible developer scheme ahead of secondary legislation. As such, we can demonstrate an active commitment to work collaboratively with the industry. These reporting requirements do not take into account homeowners and residents who are at the heart of our approach to cladding remediation, and considering both progress and impact, they must remain first and foremost in our minds. I would therefore ask Miles Briggs not to move amendments 4 and 18 to instead work with me at stage 3 to develop an amendment which reflects not only an interest of an industry but that of the constituents we seek to serve. I make the same offer to Graeme Simpson in relation to amendments 6 and 9. Again, I'm supportive of the principle, but we must ensure that the focus and detail of any such report is correct. As drafted, Amendment 6 does not align with the meaning of the single building assessment at Section 25 and would therefore be undeliverable without a significant shift in the bill. So to both Miles Briggs and Graeme Simpson, I say let's work together and get this ahead of Stage 3. Convener, in conclusion, I would ask Miles Briggs to withdraw Amendment 1 and ask the other amendments in this group not be moved. But if the amendments are pressed or moved, I ask members to vote against them. Thank you.
Thank you. Miles Briggs to wind up. Press or withdraw Amendment 1.
Thank you, Convener. And I listened to what the Minister had to say and happy to work with him at Stage 3. I do feel there is a real black hole at the end of our bill at not being able to take stock at how this bill will be effective. And so really do hope that, especially in regards to my Amendment 80, we can work to create a useful amendment at Stage 3. The Minister has outlined, and I think it's welcome that this committee can be in the future doing annual health checks, but that will fall within the committee's work timetable. The time which we'll be able to actually do an annual piece of work like that might be limited. So I think it is the burden is on the government actually to provide Parliament with updated information on how we're progressing with assessments taking place, with remedial work then being commissioned, and actually for residents and the wider public in Scotland to be able to see where this issue is not only being assessed, but actually we get to an end point where we can say that buildings are safe in Scotland and the cladding problems have been rectified. And that, I think, does need some sort of annual reporting back to Parliament beyond the committee. So with that said, happy to work with the Minister ahead of Stage 3 on what I hope can be a proper workable amendment on to bring, I think, the three amendments together. There's issues with all three, I think, could be brought together in an amendment at Stage 3. So in that case, I won't press move amendment. I won't be pressing Amendment 1.
Can I confirm that you withdraw Amendment 1?
Agreed.
Thank you. Miles Briggs seeks to withdraw Amendment 1. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Call Amendment 4 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 1. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 6 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
On the basis that the Minister is prepared to spread some of his success at Stage 3, I will withdraw.
Call Amendment 80 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 1. Miles Briggs to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 81 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 82 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 46. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 83 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 46. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 84 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 46. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 41 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're all agreed. I call Amendment 42 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 46. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 25 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 85 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 46. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not move.
The question is that Section 26 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 27 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 43 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 43 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Section 28 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that Sections 29 and 30 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 9 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 86 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 46. If Pam Duncan-Glancy to move or not move?
Not moved, convener.
The question is that Section 31 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 32 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is that the long title be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And that ends Stage 2 consideration of the bill. So thank you very much for that. We previously agreed to take the next item in private, so as that was the last public item on the agenda for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.